interesting music. Dale Jr. and Elliott Sadler seem to be enjoying themselves. Later, time to draw for the qualifying order. Earnhardt, he drew fourth. Speaking of fourth, how about champions on stage? Gordon, Hornaday, Earnhardt Jr., and Butch Gillian, 1997 Winston West champion. Saturday, Motohiro Nakachi of Japan took the inaugural qualifying lap, 38.194, 146 miles an hour. Jeff Gordon, 35.122, 158. But Jeremy Mayfield had the top car of the day. He ran 158.799, just edged out Gordon, setting that first row.
Jeremy Mayfield, you won your first race at Pocono, and now your first trip to Japan. Tell us about the experience.
Man, it's been an awesome trip for us, and we come over here and had a lot of fun, and to come here and sit on the pole, that's just a bonus. I mean, it's awesome to be here, and not only to be running good, but to be here and having fun right now.
All right, as you said, starting from the pole, tell us about this racetrack. What type of race will we see?
I think you'll see a good race. It's an awesome facility. It's got everything a racetrack ever needed, a great garage area, perfect racetrack, smooth, fast. It's going to be a good race for the fans tonight.
All right, Jeremy Mayfield starts from the pole for today's race here, Motegi.
tonight, today, here, getting ready to look at Motegi inside of it. That's coming up in the next segment here as we speak to you from Motegi this evening on TBS. On the Superstation, TBS live from Motegi, nestled here in the Yamazo Mountains, this mile-and-a-half facility such as we have never seen before. And what is this mile-and-a-half track like for a driver? Check it out with Jeff Burton.
Twin Ring is a very unique racetrack, really long straightaways. Turn one, you carry a lot of speed. You're really driving there hard. About right here, you can get back in the gas. You can stay in the gas. Then you got to come back out of it because you pick up a push and you get right back in it. Real wide racetrack, you actually got to find your way back to the wall, almost turn right a little bit. Back on the long straightaway again. Turn three is totally different than what we just did. You stop right here. Very tight corner. Your car pushes very badly. Try to stay on the bottom. Some guys will run up top to get off of turn four better. Just depends on what your car is doing. Getting off four is real important because you can get under people going down the front straightaway and beat them toward turn one.
That's one lap around this track. What a driver's paradise, Motegi. Just a little to the north here, the short track, the go-karts, about 75 miles an hour. And there's a dirt track, Saturday night specials, midgets on the dirt. You may have to go to the active safety training park to learn how to glide into those corners. Whew. Time to take a break. Head over to the Honda Museum. Saw old D.W. Waltrip in there. Then it's off to the Fun Lab. All kinds of things for young and old. Hey, how about a test ride on a new Honda motorcycle? Seems like everyone can have a great day before the real racing begins here. They've come from all over to race, including the Pride of Vancouver, number two. You might remember in racing Roy Smith, a great racer out of the West. Well, his son Gary is going to cut his teeth on this mile-and-a-half track today, and Alan Bestwick is with him.
Ken, there are a number of drivers in the field today from NASCAR's Winston West Series, and with good reason. There'll be a Winston West points race here at Motegi next year. Gary Smith is one of them. Gary, what's it like to get out there and rub fenders with Jeff Gordon and Wallace and Earnhardt and the rest of them today?
It's a great opportunity for Gary Smith here. You know, it's a great, I'm really happy to be here representing Canada. It's really an honor to race side by side with Jeff Gordon. I just hopefully we can run with him all day and get a little more experience for our Winston West points race here next year.
Now, you're from Victoria, British Columbia, and I understand your hometown pitched in a lot just to get you here to Japan.
Oh, absolutely, Alan. The town of Victoria, we raised over $20,000 in 2 weeks. You know, a lot of people put in a lot of money to get me here, and I'm just honored to be representing Victoria and Canada. Being here in Japan on racing here is a great experience for me.
Good luck today. Get yourself a top 10 finish. That's Gary Smith from Canada representing the NASCAR Winston West Series in his Canadian hometown in the race today.
He will start 27. There's the guy that will start third, last year's winner, Mike Skinner, at Suzuka came home first. Can he do it again here in Japan on TBS? Team started unpacking their toolbox. Got the cars out, ready to go to work. Recipe for a new Japanese treat. Place $500,000 worth of equipment in a 40-by-8-foot container. Leave for a month. Gently shake across the Pacific. And roll it out. Add 7 to 14 folks. And you're ready to go racing. A spicy recipe indeed here on this racetrack. Well, DW is with us. Darrell Waltrip. And he's first time out of the country. First time with a passport. Guess what he's found? A museum.
Hey, folks. Man, this is Japan. Can you believe it? We're over here with these stock cars, these big old noisy stock cars, to come over here with a Winston Cup race. Man, they got it all. You know what else they got? They got a museum, the Honda Museum, and it's got some of the neatest race cars I have ever seen in my life. Some history of Honda and how they got to where they are in the world of motorsports. And we're going to go inside and look around a little bit. Look, even on the sign it says, "Welcome, Darrell Waltrip, to the Honda Museum." Folks, this little gas-powered bicycle right here is really the beginning of the Honda Motor Company. Sir Ichiro Honda, who is the founder and the father of Honda, this was his concept, was to make riding a bicycle easier. And from that little engine and that bicycle came some of the highest tech stuff I've ever seen in my life. And we're going to look at some of it. But also, you may remember, I know I do, one of the first Hondas I ever saw. I didn't know how a six-foot fella could ever get inside of one of those and ride around, but that was one of the original Hondas that I saw in the United States. So from that little humble beginning, as they may say here in Japan, we've gone on to bigger and better things, and we're going to take a look at some of them. Hey, folks, you recognize these bikes? These bikes were ridden by American Freddie Spencer. That's the 500 world champion and the 250 world champion. He won those two championships in the same year. Nobody else has ever done that before. And he was riding a Honda, by the way. Guess what? Wouldn't you like to see Buddy Baker and Benny Parsons get down in one of these things here? They'd never get them out. You know, this car right here was driven by Ayrton Senna to the World Championship, and it's Honda-powered. And this is his teammate over here, Gerhard Berger, Alain Prost down here. All these cars have really been the standard, the benchmark in Formula One racing, and they're all Honda-powered. Holy cow. Man, I like this thing. Look at this. Got a rear view mirror. Man, you need a spotter on this thing. And, oh, wait a minute. Wonder if I could get this through customs. I don't know. I need a motor for my boat, but God, boy, look at this. Oh, wow. Got shifter, got mirror. Clear. Go ahead, Walt. Man, I like this.
Darrell Waltrip is strapped into a different race car, getting set to go. DW, your first time outside the United States in a race car. How's your experience been overseas?
I'm having a great time, and I want to thank Dale Jarrett for getting me in this car, and I want to say hi to Sarah and Jessica back home. I know they're watching tonight, but hey, this is a great facility. I'm glad I did this. Two things I never thought I'd get to do was race at Indy and come to Japan and race. So this has been an awesome experience. Here I am qualified pretty well, and the car is awesome for the race. I could win this thing. I got to try to restrain myself. I'm so excited.
Darrell Waltrip starting fifth today. Good luck, Darrell. Let's go to Steve Burns.
And Alan, we're with Dale Earnhardt, who's got a bright new paint job on this number three race car. Now, Dale, you started the season with a tremendous victory at the Daytona 500. Can you finish it the same way?
Well, I didn't hear what you said, but excited about being here today in this Coca-Cola car, and Dale Jr. being up there in another Coca-Cola car. I hope we get up there and race with him and be competitive all day. Got a lot of great people that helped put this program together with Action Performance, Fred Wagon, all the Coca-Cola people. Circus City's on board with us, the in-car camera, so we just hope to go up front and have a good day.
All right, best of luck. Dale Earnhardt starting 15th today.
This is the car of Hideo Fukuyama, 43-year-old from Suzuka City, Japan. He's a GT1 touring car and endurance racing champion here in his native country, and he's been in all of the NASCAR races overseas so far. Difference between then and now, those were on a road course where all of his experience lies. Now he gets to do it on an oval track. Command to fire engines is being given, and his interpreter's disappeared. So he won't understand what I'm saying anyway, but he feels pretty good about it. He's the best qualified of four Japanese drivers in the race. He'll start 21st. Let's go to Steve Burns.
Thank you, Alan. Mike Skinner is just getting strapped in to this slow Chevy here in Japan. They have just put the window net up. We will tell you that this race car and this driver are extremely fast. He won at Suzuka, Japan last year. He told me yesterday he wants to make it a back-to-back victory here in Japan.
Mike Stenner getting ready to go to work. Last year's winner, he'll start third. Waltrip will roll out at fifth. As you look at Youngdale taking on where his father left off, and there's the old man himself continuing to sign autographs no matter how many times a champion. A new era dawns as the 50th anniversary of NASCAR comes to conclusion. An oval NASCAR race outside of the United States. The NASCAR Thunder Special Motegi 500 from Japan, live here this evening on TBS. 500 kilometers, 311 miles, 201 laps for $1 million to kick this new facility off. A $400 million racetrack has brought out a very good crowd on a very cool day here in Japan. Field completing fire up into the back straightaway for the first time, 45 miles an hour behind the pace car. That'll also be the speed on pit road for this event. The weather on today's race, we've got temperatures a little on the nippy side. We're about 60 miles northwest of Tokyo, not in ski country, but felt darn close to it the past couple of days. Now let's take a look at the starting grid. You've got Jeremy Mayfield and Jeff Gordon up in front. For row two, it's Mike Skinner and Elliott Sadler. There's Darrell Waltrip in that number 88, going fifth with Jeff Burton alongside. Phil Elliott in seventh, Rusty Wallace sequestered in eighth. Yeah, getting to row five, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is there. Lance Norwick, the Oklahoma City kid, had a great run. In 11th position, Michael Waltrip. Beside him is Sterling Marlin. Getting to row seven, you have Bobby Hamilton and Kenny Wallace. In row eight, Dale Earnhardt starts 15th, and Ricky Craven is here with his new colors for next year. Scott Gaylord and Brendan Gaughan. What a story that kid Gaughan is. He's starting 18th. Austin Cameron and Ron Burns from the West Winston West Division in the next row back. You have Hideo Fukuyama and Jeff Davis. They're going to be starting in row 11. Randy Nelson and Kelly Turner back there in row 12. Ron Hornaday and the 97 Winston West champion Butch Gillian next. You have Gary Smith and Motohiro Nakaji. 29th and 30th, Wakita and Kia. Rich Woodland rounds out the field. Easy for me to say, right, Baker?
Yeah, I can see that.
All right, you've got 31 of them. Let's check the in cars as they come around. There you're riding with one of the Japanese, four Japanese champions here, Nakita's car right there.
Saw him back and forth on the steering wheel, getting the tires a little warm, getting all the excess rubber off the tires, making sure he got a clean surface on the tires when they drop the green flag.
As is Earnhardt, Dale Earnhardt, seven-time champion, carrying the camera with us, and as is Dale Earnhardt Jr. What a story he has been in that Grand National battle this year, the Busch Grand National Series, the star of it. He'll carry a camera as he goes toe-to-toe with Dad. How about this guy right here, Jeff Burton in the 99, carrying Bruce Lee colors today and starting sixth. You see right in front of him, Elliott Sadler. That 21 team, they brought two cars over here. Flew one over. I don't know if they flew tourists or first class. It's here, $20,000 it cost him. Mike Skinner starts third. Down on the inside of row two. One more lap and they will be racing. Skinner flanked by Sadler as we get ready to go. And there's Toshiya starting back there in 30th. Toshiya, a pretty good runner last year.
Yeah, and he's got a great nickname, too. They call him Bubba. It's on the roof of the car. He came to the United States and raced a little bit last year, and they nicknamed him Bubba. Toshiya?
As we mentioned, this track is like Darlington, buddy. It is a track that is so perfect for these cars, for these Winston Cup cars. Let's have Buddy give you a description of just what this track is about.
Let's take a look at the speedway. 80 feet wide straightaway, down into turn one, the egg-shaped racetrack. You get tremendous speed coming out of turn two, right out against the wall, down the back straightaway into an unfriendly corner, a very tight corner. right down on the white line as you come out against the wall and right back down to the start-finish line.
They call it twin ring. They could call it a quadruple ring. It's 3 degrees, 10 degrees, 17 up on the top. Pick one, go for it.
This part of the racetrack that you're looking at right now, Ken, is one of the fastest parts of the racetrack. The long sweeping turns 1 and 2, you really get ahead of steam up going down the back straightaway, and then you go into a very tight corner, which they're in now. This is turn 3, 17 and a half degree banking, as you just said, but they run right where Jeremy Mayfield's car, the 12, is, right on the white line through that corner.
Lots of bridges here. You saw one that crosses onto this 3-mile road course. They set out to build the road course, and then they thought, hey, let's do something like the Americans do. Let's put in an oval. And what an oval they have put in. As we mentioned, $400 million, $400 million spent on this facility.
Well, you level a couple of mountains, it's going to cost you a couple bucks.
Three.
For sure. Yeah. Three mountains got flattened to build this place, and it is absolutely spectacular. America's track operators ought to come over and take a look at this place. They would really be surprised.
One lap, Jimmy Howell, the flagman, indicates to the field as they go beneath him. Track and race analysis for you. They go down into turn number 1. A little over $1 million. There you see it. 31 car starting field.
Yeah, this isn't just for fun over there. The winner's going to make $150,000 plus when they win today. And fifth place is $57,000. So they're going for a lot of money also and a lot of pride.
But like you said earlier, it's bragging rights that this thing is all about.
Well, I think so. You take all these guys, when they go out and run points races, they don't let everything go to the wind. Right here, they turn what they have to turn to go fast, and they just let it all hang out.
The Japanese came to the United States. They looked at a dozen super speedways. They picked the Darlington look. And I don't think they could have done better, Baker, than that this, because no matter what you set up for, you got to compromise one end of this racetrack or the other.
Well, you want to run fast, went really fast at the fast part of the racetrack, which is 1 and 2, and really get a good run down the back straightaway. Turns 3 and 4, you're going to give up something. You're going to hear guys today saying they're real tight getting out of the corner, especially off turn 4, because you carry so much speed into turn 3.
There you are, coming into turn 3. That could be the one where you're going to hear him talking about winding up the brakes a whole lot today.
Well, Yokoso Nippon-E, welcome to Japan, getting ready to go.
Saw the number of manufacturers break down of cars, and we're getting ready as they come out of turn number 4. Flick off the first lap of 201 to be run in the Twin Ring Motegi NASCAR Thunder Special.
Green flag.
Mayfield leads them down.
Green.
For the first time outside of the United States, oval racing, NASCAR racing, here in Japan.
Well, no surprise to see Jeremy Mayfield still out in front. He has been very fast since they unloaded that car out of its crate here in Japan. You see the tire marks, that's coming off the second corner. Easy to hit that wall, buddy.
Absolutely, and those tire marks were made by our third place runner right now, Mike Skinner. You can see DW down on the bottom side. Elliott Sadler sweeps out to the wide side there, loses 3 spots that quick.
And here comes the battle for the lead. You've got Gordon on the inside, Mayfield on the outside. Live from Motegi, into the lead goes Jeff Gordon. Mayfield hangs on to second spot. And Darrell Waltrip looks like he's sent for out there. Out of turn 2, and this is the fast part of the track. You pick up about 400 RPM right here as you dive down into turn 3. Have to get on the binders hard to get through that third turn. It really tightens up on you. Here comes Earnhardt in the number 3 down to the inside. His way on the bottom. He's there on the number 60, Lance Norrie.
And Jeff coming up now, a brand new paint job for Ricky Craven. You can see him moving just by there.
Jeff Burton in the 99. Right.
riding right in front of Skinner in the 31. Rich Woodland has just pulled behind the ball. He's the first to drop out. Leaving 30. Working lap 5 of 201. Sadler in front, Hamilton second, Borden. Now give that to Skinner in the third.
Now he's still got some work to do as they go side by side down the back straightaway. Mike Skinner and Jeff Burton are really battling it out. As they go back into the corner there, you can see Jeff Burton kind of rolling out the throttle and let Mike Skinner go back into third.
Skinner was second quick in happy hour last night. They really only had about an hour to set up for the race itself. Most of the practice was before qualifying. But Skinner's been quick for qualifying trim, and he's also been quick in race trim.
Battle for the lead again. Here goes Jeremy Mayfield on the inside of Jeff Gordon down the front straightaway. They're feeling each other out right now, trading that lead back and forth.
What a battle up in front. Take a look at this run. Mayfield against Gordon for the point. Nakaji bounced off the wall a moment or two ago. The right side of his car is caved in. He just slowly went down pit road. We had five of them bounce off pit wall in practice and qualifying. Yeah, it was cold. Those tires are the Darlington tire. Tough as hockey pucks. It takes a while for them to come in.
We got two in trouble down in turn number 3.
Where we thought we might have trouble, indeed there is. There you see the number 26 looping is Ron Burns. Battered in the back end. And there's another collected down there as well. Ron Burns, number 26, yellow is down. Caution on the racetrack. Burns, a 54-year-old racer, had his birthday on the 19th of this month, a couple days ago. We have to tell you the 19th because time zones have changed so much, I'm not sure what day of the week it is here. But he was really happy to be here. He said he's always wanted to race with his heroes. He only got a few laps to do it today before bouncing off the wall. But I think he's had a bigger smile than anybody else in the garage area all weekend long. Jeff Gordon putting on a tremendous show up in front. And with him, Jeremy Mayfield. That has been the story for the point. But right behind him, Skinner has been duking it out with a 99. Darrell Waltrip looking really tough. See how they do later. 8, 12 3/10 miles down. First incident in lap 6 going into turn 3. 3 cars were involved down there. We can show you what happened.
Well, 3 wide going into the corner just doesn't work. That's Burns on the bottom. Gilliland is outside in the red car. They come together. Burns loses it. Round and round he goes and boom, into the wall for the back end. He's still on pit road trying to get it fixed, but nobody's working hard on that.
Alan Bestwick.
Well, you can see the damage to the back end of the Ron Burns car. Very heavy. In fact, he's just been told by his crew to take it back behind the wall into the garage. Wanted so badly to get some laps on this racetrack with the Winston Cup drivers. His day will be very short today. Butch Gilliland, the 97 Winston West champ. Just mostly cosmetic damage. The left side door panel punched in. Other than that, he's okay after a visit to pit road. To Steve Burns.
Alan, Elliott Sadler made a pit stop. Now, he's been one of the fastest cars here, but his car is very tight. It doesn't want to turn in the corners. They pulled out 3 spring rubbers. These sit as inserts in the springs. They pulled out both 2 of them on the front, both front sides and the left rear. Buddy Baker, I have never seen him take 3 spring rubbers out at the same time.
That means the right front is way, way too stiff, and they're trying to make it grab a little bit better, making it softer so it'll get a better bite getting in the corner. And kind of taking some bite out of the car so it'll get good grip going in the corner. So that car had too stiff a right front corner on it.
Ron Burns traveling 7,000 miles to run just a little less than 7 laps on this mile and a half track at Motegi. And there you see his number 26, the Caremore Vitamin car. Looks like it needs some more vitamins out there.
Well, at least he got a bunch of guys who can fix it. His full-time job is as a reconditioner. They paint about 75 cars a day at his business, so bring it on home, Ron. They'll fix it for you.
You know, I was just watching a car really on the go as the number 2 of Rusty Wallace. He has come from 8th to 5th all of a sudden, and we just, he slipped through there so fast getting into the corners. He made up a lot of positions without getting noticed.
There is a guy who just can't get enough of racing. You come out here in the morning, and you find Rusty Wallace right there in the garage first thing.
Oh, he's and the last to leave. He is really wired. I tell you what, if he was a line of electricity, he'd be a 440.
Well, we've seen the retirement of 54-year-old Ron Burns out of Phoenix, Arizona. He's happy just to be here, that guy in that green and white car. He said, I've exceeded all my goals, not my dreams. Still wants to do some Winston Cup racing down the road. All right, as we ride with him for just a moment, again, you are at Motegi. It is in Japan where Jeremy Mayfield has the advantage. And you see Jeff Gordon there in second, and you see Jeff Burton, number 99, in third. You get ready for a go.
Ken, you can see how valuable it is to clean those tires off well. You see them going back and forth there. Get that temperature up. This is a very hard tire.
Jeff Gordon lies in second. We asked Gordon about what he thinks his strengths are in racing.
Where I've really come along is to try to be a smarter driver, to know when to save the tires, when to save fuel, when to, you know, be patient, and when to be aggressive, when to really go for it. And it's not that, you know, you're sitting there and you're not driving hard the whole race, but what happens is you know the limits, and you can feel the limits of the tire. You just know when you're running over what that car is capable of.
Coming down into lap 10, back under green. Got Mayfield out in front. Looks like he's got his heart set on staying up on that point. Gordon lies right in second, and a very fired up Jeff Burton. In fact, all of these Winston Cup stars, it's bragging rights, folks, to win the first super speedway race outside of the United States. That's what this is all about. Put your name in the record book. Here comes Rusty. Look at him on the inside of Skinner for fourth.
Skinner will roll out of the accelerator because this corner is so important. You cannot overrun it. They're back in the throttle, as you can well hear here, as they start up out of the corner hard in the throttle.
For the lead, Gordon back in front. And here comes the guy from Virginia, Bruce Lee Cullors. Anniversary of Bruce Lee's death 25 years ago. So he's got those black death colors. Famed in the movies of Bruce Lee. And here he comes, Burton on the attack. Oh, he's ready to put a hand on Gordon. Or at least a fender. Or a foot.
All week long, that car has been one of the quickest in every practice. And look at it, handle right on that white line through the corner.
And he won last week in Homestead, Florida, the Busch Grand National race. Started 23rd in that one to win it. He's been starting well back in the field week after week and still finishing up front. Today, he's got an up front starting position and obviously a strong horse under him.
Here we are out of turn four and back into the main straightaway. Across the line they come. Gordon in front, Burton in second. Riding in third is Mayfield. It's Wallace in fourth, Skinner in fifth, and in sixth. There you have Darrell Waldrip with seventh, belonging to Bill Elliott. Just behind Elliott in the 94. Well, let's watch this for just a moment here as Mayfield is ready to come on the attack against 99.
You can see the front end losing a little bit of grip to 99 there. He was handling so very well as the tires are getting hotter and hotter. He seems to be pushing just a little bit from the center of the corner to the straightaway. He's losing a little bit of time to Gordon, our leader.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has got himself in eighth position at the present time. Our scoring has gone away, so we'll just pick them up as they come around for you. And we've got Earnhardt Jr. up into eighth. Back straightaway in that Coca-Cola number one car.
Fourth, fifth, and sixth right there. You can see Rusty Wallace right on the white line. Mike Skinner in the 31 fighting on the outside there. And Darrell Waltrip, a new inspiration to everybody in the garage area this week. He has just been walking on a cloud.
Well, he said he's never had a car with as much engine as that number 88 has got in it. He loves the Robert Gates power plant that's under his foot. And that thing handles incredibly well. That is Black and Decker, for those of you who have followed the history of Robert Yates Racing. Just about everybody who has ever driven for Yates has won with that car. And Waltrip won a whole lot of races in cars number 88 in the days he drove for Dicar.
Steve Burns can add.
Hey, Dick, you're exactly right. I talked to Darrell the other day. He said he won 29 races at Dygard Racing with Robert Yates as the engine builder. He said, in fact, he should have won the championship in 1979, but the driver, well, he said the driver wasn't mature enough to do it at that point.
You know, the thing that really makes you feel good about what he's doing right now is Dale Jarrett said, let's put him in this race car. He'll take care of it. He'll run it hard. A lot of people thought he was over the hill. You can see good equipment. He's not over the hill. He runs very well.
This is a critical race for Waltrip today in that 88. He needs to have a good showing here because it's a big question mark as far as 1999 is concerned. Hey, here comes Skinner. He's after Wallace. He's got him. Mike Skinner down the inside, and that low is number 31. Whips it down to the bottom of the racetrack and takes another position. Skinner coming on, goes into fourth.
He's been a great story here. Bounced the car off the wall in the first practice session, and they went to work, straightened it out. They had to change a whole bunch of parts on it. They don't even know if the frame is straight, but Skinner said maybe he ought to do that more often. The car ran better after he bounced it off the wall.
Sterling Marlin is up to ninth, and you've got Michael Waltrip now in 10th. Bobby Hamilton is 11th. Dale Earnhardt, the giant, back there in 12th.
We have two groups right now, three cars that are running very, very well. First, second, and third right here. Fourth, fifth, and sixth. But just behind them, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is on the move.
Trying to close up on Waltrip in the 88 is Dale Earnhardt Jr. There you see that number one.
Battle for the lead down the front straightaway. Jeff Burton has really turned it up here. You can see on the outside there, Jeff Gordon trying to hold him off. You cannot do it from the outside. He loses two spots going into turn one.
But, Buddy, don't you think if this race goes on, they'll use up a little more track and be able to make it hang on the outside?
That's what they're trying to do right now. But you can see they're using a lot of racetrack up. You heard them say earlier they had to turn right. But right now they're having to turn left and hope that the car turns coming off turn two. They're using all that back straightaway coming out of turn two.
I'll make a prediction for you right now. In the year 2000, look for the Virginians to be back. Burton and Sadler with the Wood Brothers. And, of course, everyone knows the story, I'm sure, in the U.S., that Mike Beam has left Bill Elliott to join Elliott Sadler for the 99 season. Look out for him really strong in 2000.
There's a right. Gap in the wall
Here. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
They're just starting to come your way behind the wall.
Okay, thanks.
Everybody's tight, guys. That's what they're saying.
Everybody.
Everybody.
Got another one breaking down in turn two. That's Kelly Tanner. Back with you live, coming around to complete 20 laps this time of 201 to be run. About 31 miles there, and there you see the battle. That's the battle between the 99 of Jeff Burton and Jeremy Mayfield. They're having their own struggle out here right now. It's been a good one. They continue to make war right up on the top. Just behind them, you have Jeff Gordon in third, followed by Mike Skinner in fourth. And riding fifth is Rusty Wallace with Darrell Waltrip in sixth. Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Trouble. Back straightaway.
The 09, the Japanese driver, in trouble. Moto Hero Nakaji.
That's the second time he's been in trouble today.
Good night, Moto Hero.
Jeff Gordon missed him by less than 2 inches coming off that corner as he spun around. Jeff Gordon just made it on the inside to get by.
All in all, not a good day for Moto Hero. 20 laps complete. And that could be Toot Finney, Termini on this car number 09, the Big Daddy car. So you get it cranked up. Looks like it just went out from beneath him there.
Yeah, it did.
Well, you know, nobody has a lot of experience on this racetrack. You talk to the drivers, including the Japanese drivers, and say, how many laps have you got here? And most of them have got little or none at all, just like the American drivers. So it's no surprise to see we're having some wrecks.
I was just informed the whole right side of the 24 car indeed did make contact. The sheet metal damage to Jeff Gordon's car.
Gordon in trouble. Been right up in the thick of it from the outset. And they say it is scraped up on the number 24. Check it out for you. Gary Smith is back in the garage here. Take a look on the replays to what happened here. Right behind the leaders.
Oh, he can't get it. He nailed him. Contact.
Pounded him in the door. At 160 miles an hour, he picks it up and keeps going. The 24, not the 09.
Be interesting to see how the crew does on Gordon's car.
There you see. And let's find out more on the story on Gary Smith. Remember, we talked with him just before we got on the air with our live coverage today at Motegi.
The nice part of this damage on 24 car, it is in the door area. It's not around the running gear part of the car, just behind the right front wheel, though. There is damage there.
Let's go down to the pits right now with Steve Burns.
Ken, you're exactly right with Gary Smith. Gary, you said at the top of the show you were so excited to be here. What puts you in the garage area right now?
The Molson Canadian Thunderbird just got a bit of a vibration going, and something let go on the motor there. I'm not quite sure. Just had a vibration right from the get-go, and we just couldn't get up to speed. A little bit disappointing for my first Winston Cup start, but just really proud to be here, and it was very exciting, and I'd like to thank everybody back in Victoria and say hi to all the family back there. And it was a short day for us, but we'll be back.
All right, let's go to Alan Bestwick.
This is one of the right side tires coming off of Jeff Gordon's car. There you see the damage to it. He has gotten up against the outside wall. Doesn't look like the damage is significant. Ray Evernham is still talking about it with Jeff and the rest of the crew. They did only change the right side tires here, and we'll try and get a word with Ray here in just a minute. How bad's the damage, Ray?
Looks like pretty bad sheet metal. You know, he doesn't feel like it got in the wheels, but the right side of the car's pretty tore up, but who knows, maybe that'll help.
All right. So Ray Evernham taking kind of a good attitude about the race here in Japan, but right now they've got some damage to ponder.
We'll take a break right here. Try to get more on this Jeff Gordon story for you. Live from Motegi, Japan, the first super speedway race for NASCAR outside of the United States, and it's a barn burner. Complete 44 and 9/10 miles, and what a story it has been to date. A battle up in front that has seesawed back and forth. We've had Burton, we've had Mayfield, we've had Gordon, and now we have Gordon in trouble out here after he took a T-bone in the door. The Japanese driver, Motohiro Nakaji, just flat looked like he lost it, and he caught Gordon's car.
I thought you were going to let me do the name at least, but anyway.
Oh, go ahead.
No.
Baker, it's yours.
They were
it's
going
yours.
Down the back straightaway. Jeff Gordon almost made it by, but hard contact in the door area. They're not real concerned about the running gear itself because it looked like it's only cosmetic damage to the sheet metal.
Earnhardt Jr. having a very good run. He's in 12th. We asked the 98 Busch Series champion what surprised him the most during this 98 season.
I knew the determination was there and the savvy or the will to get in there and drive the race car and want to win and want to go out and race good. And it just took a little time for him to learn how to handle the competition and how to handle the racing. It was a little bit too aggressive at times. And he settled down and he's really, goes after it. And he's competitive and knows when to be competitive. He's learned a lot in a short time.
Yeah, as they get ready to go green, we've got the number one, Earnhardt Jr., 12th, Earnhardt Sr., 13th. Oh, that could be fun. Let's see if it's any fun for Jeff Gordon now. As you see, he has dropped back into fifth spot on that start. It looks like he's about to lose another position. He's up on the high side. What do you think, buddy?
Well, I'm just watching Jeremy Mayfield now in the 12. He didn't have any trouble, but you get offline and get in that outside groove, and he's still out there, Jeff Gordon is just behind. But you can see all these cars having a little bit of a handling problem. You can see the cars dancing around just a little bit until they get the heat in these tires. They don't handle very well, and it is a hard compound. So these guys are really working hard right now. Jeff Gordon on the outside finally got into the inside groove, and he's back up to full song.
Well, Goodyear took a very conservative position on the tires. It was a smart thing to do. You don't want to go halfway around the world and discover that your tires are too soft and they blister, you have problems. There have been no tire problems whatsoever. It just takes a little while for him to come in. Rusty Wallace on the high side. His obviously are not in just yet.
That's for seventh spot as the 99 dips down to the inside. And here comes Jeff Burton after Gordon. Jeff Burton is putting on some show here in Motegi, Japan.
And that's Ricky Craven in that black and yellow car there just in front of DW back here. You get used to seeing that car. What a great effort the first time out for Ricky Craven and his new team.
Ninth spot on Gordon, or rather for Craven, in that 58. He's all excited about next year, but I'm excited about this 99. Jeff Burton looks strong. A couple of fine races this year for Checkers. Here he comes closing on Gordon. But look at the number four right in there. Bobby Hamilton's having a very good ride. In six currently as they come back to the line. Completing lap number, what, 32? Guess we're there. Now look at Waltrip sinking down on the inside. Craven just behind him as he hugs that bottom line. Around they go, and remember the wide corner is one and two. The tight corner is three and four. You go downhill a bit. That back stretch is elevated some 15 feet higher than the main stretch, and you really sweep down 400 RPMs more. Look at the 99. Gather it up. Come into the main straightaway. Burton on the bottom, Gordon on the outside.
Side by side down towards turn one. You can see he has the preferred line. Gordon will roll out, get right back to the bottom of the racetrack. Bobby Hamilton closing very fastly in the four car just behind him.
Hamilton could be a spoiler. I had breakfast with him today, and he has really not shown a whole lot so far, but he said he thought he had the combination to get the job done this afternoon. We'll see. Rusty Wallace looking to take his spot away from him.
Yeah, six. And Rusty takes that spot away. Remember, Rusty won that first race in Japan, the modern day. Tiny Lund won a race here years ago. And of course, a lot of us that felt that Tiny Lund was one of the all-time greatest. We need to give that one up. Give him a little credit for that performance he put on the road course here. But Wallace, in this current series, was the guy that won the first time over here at Suzuka. And he is so determined to win this race. He has been as focused on this as any event he's run this year.
Absolutely, he's focused, and he's been a delight to be around. Look at Dale Earnhardt Jr. and his dad right behind him, following in the tire tracks as they close in on Ricky Craven.
Everybody's been watching these two guys and practice sessions here so far to see which one of them would have the closest time, the fastest time. There's a swap of fifth spot right there.
Yes, indeed. Sterling Marlin had some very good times. And sweeping under him comes Gordon as well for six, and Marlin number 40 back to seven.
So much aerodynamics. That 24 looked like it may be a little bit faster than before he got the right side bent up. Is running very, very well.
In eighth spot is Darrell Waltrip, number 88. Then Craven in the 58 is in ninth. And you have Earnhardt Jr., number one, in the 10th position. That's through 37 laps complete, 57 and 3/10 miles. Well, we're kind of waiting to see what's going to be the outcome here of this charge. Oh, and you see the 99 wiggle there? He was as stable as anyone, but as you come off that corner, down out of turn number two, you just have to be right on it, and right on the edge is where these guys always drive. You could see him for just a moment edging almost over it. So number 12 stays right up in it. There comes that great car of Jeremy Mayfield. Complete 63 and a half miles, and up in smoke has gone Wakita. Famed Japanese national champion has brought out the second caution of the race. There you see him. We can show you what happened here in just a moment. It was some pyrotechnics.
Well, there he is coming off the racetrack. They've had a lot of trouble with that car all weekend long. They had a radiator fail on him. They've had clutch problems where they had to push start it, and now something has let go big time, whether it's the engine or an oil line. He's gone. Kelly Tanner behind him has also had engine trouble. He's been in the pits many times this afternoon.
And there you see Wakita walking away. Can't be too happy about this. Japanese really wanted to put on a good show on their first opportunity in their own country, but it's not going to happen for Katsuro Wakita. Mike Skinner up in front as they complete the 41st and start working the 42nd lap. He just slipped down through and snuck into the lead a moment or two before an engine erupted on Wakita. So Skinner. Now, Skinner was the first guy to have trouble here. First day of practice, what, a minute and a half in? Second lap in the wall in turn two. And he cuffed it pretty strong. Here you see Elliott Sadler now driving for the Wood Brothers. And what a rejuvenated gang. I mentioned to you, this team is just totally revitalized. They're so excited about Mike Beam joining them. And they almost see it as a relief. They could go do the business part and everything but the aerodynamics. The Wood Brothers, the younger Wood Brothers, they love that aerodynamic business. But they think that putting Mike Beam in there with Elliott Sadler is a winning combination, and I agree. Let's go to Alan Bestwick with more on the 21.
Well, I just got finished talking with Eddie Wood about Elliott Sadler's car. Remember, Steve Burns reported earlier on that quick stop they made. They pulled three spring rubbers out. Well, they went too far. So they just put one back in the left rear tire, trying to tighten him up just a little bit.
Well, there's the story from Alan Bestwick as they try to get Elliott Sadler just a little more racy. Now we'll squeeze in another break and then be back with you live in Motegi, Japan. The action is Winston Cup racing, NASCAR racing, out of the U.S. for the first time. They come down to take green. You let Mike Skinner up in front.
Oh, trouble on the start there. You can see several cars getting together there, almost spinning out.
They gather it up. They're on their way with Jeremy Mayfield in second.
One of them was Ricky Craven in the 58 there. He was all the way sideways as they come down towards the start finish line. Somebody checked up and they got together.
But there is no flag out. They're all safely underway. Here comes number one, clear. Scoots down to the all inside. Clear. All clear, they say, to Dale Earnhardt Jr. As he's got that sail set and strong. The end of the headwind as he comes down out of turn
all
number four.
Clear.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. around Waltrip. That will put him into seventh, drop Waltrip to eighth. Craven was in ninth on the restart. And now you see number three sorting himself out. Here comes Earnhardt Sr.
Clear all around, Dale, no pressure.
That's Kenny Wallace in the number 55 car.
Oh, Bill Elliott, that's a wake-up call. We don't have horns. That'll get your attention.
Cameron in the 11. He had some very fast time in practice. Winston West driver in that number 11. Getting a little bit of a thrill out there. Here's Bill Elliott steaming along in 12th, number 94.
Michael Waltrip in the 7 car. Just behind him, Lance Norrick in the 60.
Kodak, number four. Here's that double zero staying up in that thing. I think that may be a lap down. He's in this group. I don't believe he is in this lead lap. But again, scoring is out. So just got to rely on Eagle Eye Baker here. And whatever we can get as they come around.
Well, I can tell you that Elliott Sadler looked pretty quick right there as he made a move on the inside in the 21 car. They've been adjusting on that car. They talked to Mike Beam a long distance today and tried to get rid of some of the push in that car. It went too far. Now they've made some more adjustments. I think he'll get it right before the day's over.
Hey, you see that number 16? That's that kid gone. And that's the kid that played basketball for Georgetown. He is some story, the kid in the 16. This is a fully accredited NCAA Division I basketball player, and he is giving it one whale of a good ride in that Napa number 16. Brendan Gaughan, he came in from off-road racing. But the real story on that guy is, hey, he's got a couple of those rings that they give out for a championship playing for Georgetown. Big East. Here you see him, Brendan Gaughan. He wants to be gone like with the wind in years to come, he says.
He wants to be gone like Elliott Sadler. He passed him down the front straightaway and already opened up about a 6-car length lead on Brendan Gaughan.
Well, you can tell that he's tough because he used to room with Allen Iverson, and his only job in practice was to put stitches in Iverson. He said, I got him for 70 stitches. That's 7-0.
Oh,
here we go.
Here comes the stitches.
Oh, man.
Boom.
The 00 to Chia. You could see him get in trouble, and then it was away to the wall.
What he did, he went into turn three, got up in the loose stuff. The high part of the racetrack has a lot of dust and debris up there. He got up in there, the rear wheels lost grip, and around he went.
Caution number three. And how much fun it must have been to have been turned around and watch everybody coming at him. That's the 82 of Randy Nelson there, all bent up. Skinner takes
the caution.
He was
just a victim of circumstance.
Yeah.
As they came around to complete lap number 50, 77 miles into this race. Yeah, you can, I think, say goodbye to the hopes of Toshiya here today. At 50 laps, leading was Mike Skinner. And in the second spot was Mayfield. We get another look right here for a moment.
Way, way up. He's much higher than he should be. And here he goes, round and round, and boom, into the wall.
No, he missed
the
wall.
No, I guess he did miss the wall.
This is where he got collected.
Yeah, there just wasn't enough room, and Randy Nelson nailed him.
I misspoke. There were four cautions. That is the fourth caution of the day. Again, we're working without any scoring, so it's Bagess and Bagali here some of the time. Almost. That's a hard hit for Randy Smith. Or rather for Gary Smith. Here's Gary coming out.
You can see he's getting the stars back out of his head there as he leans over, waves to the crowd. That's always a good sign. He's on the inside of the inside guardrail there, kind of dejected.
That's Randy Nelson. I said Smith, again, misspoke. That's Randy Nelson who had that trouble, not Smith. Okay, they're checking out those drivers after a pretty hard clip up here in turn number four. We're into the 50-lap rundown. Actually, we're working lap number 41. Got scoring through lap 47, which isn't much help with what's going on the racetrack. We'll take a quick break and be back once again. Hey, you hungry? Oh, a few pancakes.
What is that?
I thought it was a Frisbee.
Darrell Waltrip would think it's his name.
I want this. My favorite driver is Jeff Gordon. My
favorite driver is Rusty Wallace. This.
危ないね。日本の土屋圭一勝ってほしいけど、マイク好きなの方が早いと思う。お気に入りのドライバーはデイル・アーハート。
Whatever the language, you can read it and read it well. Dale Earnhardt and all those other great stars who have really made an impression on the Japanese racing fans. There are some 50,000 seats here at Motegi. From whence we're speaking to you live, I'm with Buddy Baker, Dr. Dick Bergen along, Ken Squire. After 53 of 201 laps, and the track scoring is down, so that's creating a big of problem. Hey, we can join Steve Burns right now on the Ricky Craven story on pit road.
Yeah, Ken, he's got some pretty significant sheet metal damage to the left front of that car. They've got about five different colors of duct tape on the hood, trying to keep the hood pins in place. This is their second stop they made. They also were going to spring the car to make sure the alignment was okay, but he's back on the racetrack right now, but he's got significant sheet metal damage to the left front of the number 58.
Pittsburgh colors on the number 58. Those will be the colors for Ricky Craven next year with this new team. Very excited about it. The guy who led so many laps in Japan at Suzuka a year ago had hoped for a better thing than this.
Well, Ricky Craven is like a lot of people. His crew is borrowing things by the looks of it. The teams here in the garage have had to do that. They all got one container worth of stuff to bring with them, and it seems like nobody had quite enough stuff, so they've all been borrowing back and forth.
for the people that just joined us, the damage that he had to the left front corner there was done on a restart about 15 or 20 laps ago. So they got together there on the restarts, and that's where he got his damage.
Well, Jeff Gordon, with the race here in Japan, Jeff Gordon gave us his feelings on these Japanese fans and how they perceive Winston Cup racing.
They're very enthusiastic about motorsports. They love racing. And, you know, you come to a place like this and you expect to, you know, walk through the garage area and nobody know who the drivers are and who it, and yet they've got all the magazines, the diecast cars, the t-shirts, the hats, they've got it all. You know, somehow they found it either, you know, through things in the United States or over here, and they're as enthusiastic and as excited about racing as anybody in the world is.
They sure are. And they're having a great day, even on the cool side over here. To heck with the economy, to heck with the cold weather. We've got a great race going at Motegi, and through 54 laps, hello indeed, through 54 laps, 83 and a half miles. Let's see if we can give you a little bit more of a rundown, in as much as the track scoring isn't working. So, as we say, we're picking them up as they come by, and here's how we see them. In the lead would be Mike Skinner. Second, you have Jeremy Mayfield. And then in third is the number 99. That's Jeff Gordon doing a whale of a job. Jeff Gordon's there in fourth. You have Bobby Hamilton in the fifth spot right now, Rusty Wallace. Then Sterling Marlin in sixth. Running in seventh is Dale Earnhardt Jr. In eighth, you'll have Darrell Waltrip. In ninth is Earnhardt Sr. Then in tenth is the 55 of Kenny Wallace. In 11th is Bill Elliott. And going 12th is number 11, Austin Cameron. 13th is the number 4, that's Bobby Hamilton, with 14th, Elliott Sadler, and 15th, number 16, Brendan Gaughan. Really doing it. In the 16th position is Michael Waltrip. That's 16th for Michael Waltrip. 17th is Ron Hornaday, and he's been in and out of the pits a bit. 18th would be car number 10, Butch Gilliland. And then in 19th is the number 60, Lance Norwick, the Oklahoma City lad. Hey, his dad came with him. They're having a great time. In 20th is number 67, Scott Gaylord. And 21st is 98, Fukuyama. Hadayo Fukuyama Baker. What, he could say that?
Well, yeah, he wanted to do that, yeah.
You know, following up on what Jeff Gordon said about the fans, they really have been terrific with the drivers. They just, so many of them have shown up here with the fan wear that shows the colors of their favorite driver, but they are so different than American fans. Here in the garage area, instead of surrounding the drivers to get autographs, they very politely, one after another, just line up.
Yeah, 26, Ron Burns is back here. Let's make quick mention of that and get right to Alan Bestwick.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is having a good run. He's in seventh spot, a couple of spots ahead of his dad. Here's Tony Urey Jr., who's calling the shots today. What's Dale Jr. saying about his car?
We really got a real tight race car today. I mean, the body's not quite up to par to what it should be, so we're really fighting it. When he gets behind somebody, it's really getting in trouble real tight. But we're going to try to do the best we can do here today.
You locked up the NASCAR Busch Series Championship together just a weekend ago. Thoughts on that? You really haven't had much time to reflect on it.
No, we really ain't had much time to think about that. I mean, it's nice, and I congratulate all the guys back home and thank them a lot. But we wanted to get in here and get our feet wet and see what we could come up against these Winston Cup guys. We're really looking forward to next year. This just gives us a little taste.
And they're not having a bad taste right now, running up in the top 10, and again, ahead of the other Dale.
Yeah, 7. Dale Jr. in front of Senior, who is in 9th.
That car was purchased from Andy Petrie after Steve Park had so many, many wrecks at the first part of the year. It was more of a show car, and it was sent over here because they were running out of cars. I tell you, he's doing a great job. Baker, this car was not a short track car or a car for a flat track.
Baker, you got to tell that story about when Junior was out here, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and we had a little trouble. The track might have been for Senior, remember? Senior was on the radio, a little concerned about how fast kid was going.
Yeah, he called in and he said, as Earnhardt Jr. went by him going in the corner, he called some of the guys that worked for him. He said, somebody go and at least tell him it's slick out here.
Oh.
He's got some damage to the right rear quarter panel on that one car also that's hurting it a little bit down the straightaway.
Ninth place, Senior coming around, ready to take green. Once again, they'll be working lap number 53. Live from Motegi, Japan on TBS, ready on a restart. Mike Skinner will bring him down, last year's winner. With him will come Jeremy Mayfield. And right along, Jeff Burton in the 99. Gordon still fourth. Got center punched a little earlier up here in the corner. One of the Japanese drivers lost it, tagged him in the door. Still staying right up here in the thick of it.
Hey, pace car is off. Green.
Go. Here we go. Super Speedway racing outside of the United States. Hope you're enjoying it this evening in the States. It's grand here in Japan. And there goes that number one up on the high
side. Still there.
Clear.
And both sides.
Cleared,
all clear.
Gone. Yeah, the number three on the
inside
high side.
Now, inside,
too.
40, inside, by himself.
Like father, like son. They're both
they're
out
behind
there.
Him. They're
look
behind
at Wallace sneak down to the inside and go under Gordon.
Sterling Marlin out, there in the 40 out. Gets by Earnhardt Jr., slides up as Jr. makes that wonderful move the Earnhardts have made famous on the bottom side.
Riding for the
battle.
Lead for the front position at the line. Even across, and now give it back to Mayfield.
Mayfield seems better when the tires are colder, but once they warm up, Skinner seems to be a bit better.
Jeremy Mayfield loves this type of racetrack. He won this year up at the Long Pond racetrack up in
Pennsylvania.
Senior down to the inside. Dale Earnhardt Jr.
They're
and Dale Earnhardt Sr. Don't call anybody little in this group.
One
they are
the
champions.
Inside.
Look at this. Three wide into the main straightaway.
Still there, three wide. Inside, out clear on high side.
Sterling Marlin just
still
noses
inside.
Back in front of Earnhardt Sr.
Still inside.
Darrell Walter making a move on
inside.
Earnhardt. Earnhardt drives very, very hard down
still there.
Look at that 88 car. Come up out of that corner with Darrell Walter.
Okay, you're clear. Clear all around.
Look at Elliott. Clear all around my purple bunny. All over out there. Here comes Bobby Hamilton into it and Kenny Wallace in the 55.
Trio of champions here going at it.
They've come over 7,000 miles to put this show on, and put it on they are.
Well, they don't have to worry about points. The whole deal here is to win this race, and everybody seems to be running a bit harder than they ordinarily would.
Lap 60 complete. And you've got number 12, Mayfield, in front with Skinner in second. And that 99 hanging right in there, Jeff Burton in third. Go ahead, buddy.
Look at this side-by-side race. These guys swap. That's Michael Waltrip in the 7. He used to drive this 21. The new kid on the block, Elliott Saddle, fighting very, very hard on the insides. He makes the move by Michael Waltrip off the corner.
Elliott Saddle fighting there back in 13th, 14th position. Just outside the top 10. Trying to nail it down. We're mentioning these positions. Let's go back at lap 60. And you find in fifth spot Gordon. And in the sixth position, Dale Earnhardt Jr. on the rise. Sterling Marlin in 7th with Waltrip in 8th. Earnhardt Sr. in 9th. Bill Elliott up to 10th. And in 11th is Bobby Hamilton. And again, no sign of scoring. It's a little tricky. Had 4 cautions. We'll bring you up to date on the retirees. Elliott Saddler coming by in that 21. And the challenge is back on again as Michael Waltrip comes after him. Michael Waltrip out of the 21 car for next year to take over the 7. You talk about bragging rights. These two aren't going to give up on it.
Always interesting to see what happens when a guy gets out of his ride and he gets the first opportunity to race with it. You think Michael Waltrip's motivated? Oh, boy.
Michael Waltrip's been learning Japanese while he's over here. He's got the dictionary, the whole 9 yards. You know his brother talking about how that sign said, welcome to Michael Waltrip, to Darrell Waltrip, as he went into the museum. You know what the sign really said? Please wipe off your shoes. That's Darrell. Thought it was a sign for him.
Now Michael's got another good reason to run hard here. He's going to leave this racetrack and head to Hawaii, where he's going to meet his wife for their 5th anniversary party. Going to spend a week in Hawaii. It'll cost him a couple of bucks, I would think.
Yeah, beauty, huh?
Ricky Creighton's going to do it right. He's going back up to Maine, up to New England. Thanksgiving up there with the family up in the woods.
Hey,
up.
Nice.
Elliott Saddler, you can tell the 21 car is still nose heavy in the corner, pushing out towards the outside wall, not getting a very good grip out of the corner.
And that's been the key complaint of most drivers here. We very seldom have heard anybody say that their car is loose. They've all worked with a push. Everybody seems to have problems with the understeer.
15th position is that number 21, Elliott Sadler. And in 14th at the present time is Michael Waltrip in the number 7. Now you're back on the nose of this race. As you watch that number 12, hustle, Jeremy Mayfield. What a hustler he is. What a haircut he brought this time.
Yeah, I've been wondering about that, Baker. Now, since Jeremy Mayfield dyed his hair white, and a bunch of his crew dyed their hair white, and you test for those guys, are we going to see you with white hair?
Well,
he's
God's
got white
taking,
hair.
God's
what do you think
taking
that
care
is?
Of this right now as we speak.
Yeah, this will be the last race Jeremy's going to run with the white hair. He's going to let his dark hair grow back in again. I'd like to have any hair grow back in again myself.
Getting a little reflection off the sun here. What little there is of it. Looking further back in the field, Sterling Marlin in 7th, and in 8th is the 88 of Darrell Waltrip. Driving for the recovery, Dale Jarrett. Dale, we hope you're watching and enjoying, and can't wait to see you get back on it at Daytona. Structural stuff.
And the Roush guys say that Mark Martin didn't do the surgery after all this week. He just took a shot, and they say the bones in his back are healing. He's not here because he thought he was going to have surgery. So if you're watching, Mark, we hope you're feeling better, too.
Earnhardt Sr., number nine position for that number 3. The man in black changing colors for this race. Now here comes Waltrip. Waltrip searching, looking for that 7th spot.
And got it down in the turn one. That 88 looked like it's on a string right on the bottom of the racetrack. Darrell Waltrip, a very, very patient race car driver. He knows he has a fine ride here.
Hey, we've got 100 miles of the 300 complete. Yep, 65 complete. Hey, those diecast cars are going strong here at Motegi, live on TBS. Back with you live, and let's catch you up on the storylines here. Earnhardt versus Earnhardt Jr. Earnhardt Jr. is up in 6th, and Earnhardt Sr. is 9th. The Gordon domination, well, you can't call it that today. He is seeking to get back up into the top 4, running in 5th at the present time. The Japanese racers, not a story. Buddy?
We have trouble in turn 4 right now.
Caution's out.
Yeah, battling the track really is the story there. Here comes the 5th caution of the day. Is it for the 26?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, Ron Burns lost it up there in the 4th corner. They put the caution out for him.
Well, he's already got the thing.
All that damage wasn't done just now. He's been working on tearing that one up for a while. He's backed it in the wall twice now.
Well, as damaged as it is, that makes it hard to hang on to the back end of the car.
He looks like one of those patients you see in a cartoon in the hospital with all that tape all over him.
Yep. Should mention that they are running the same, some debris on the racetrack as well. They're running the same configuration they ran at Atlanta with the rear spoilers up an inch and a half and the nose down a little bit. The cars were all sent over here with the old configuration, so a lot of people had to air freight new spoilers in. And
is that a banner?
No, that's some tape off somebody's race car.
Ah. Hey, let's see if we can't, and it's off the 58. Off Craven's car. He's got all kinds of interesting colors and tape on that yellow and black old pirate. Let's just see if we can catch you up as they were running at lap 69. This caution has come out at lap 71 of the 201 to be run. So stick with us. As we say, we have no scoring. So we'll just bring you on down through the top 20 positions as best we can. In the lead is that number 12 of Jeremy Mayfield, and you have Skinner right there with him in second, followed by the 99, Jeff Burton. In the 4th spot would be Rusty Wallace, and in 5th is that number 24 of Gordon. Then in 6th, you'd have number 1, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and in the 7th spot, well, back comes Waltrip again, Darrell Waltrip. And in 8th, there's the number 40. That's Sterling Marlin, all the same lap. In 9th is Dale Earnhardt Sr. Then in 10th is the number 4. You have Bobby Hamilton. In 11th is number 94. And they're all going to pit. This will change it all. But let me continue this for you so you get an idea where they are. Bill Elliott in 11th. Then in 12th was Kenny Wallace. In 13th was Austin Cameron. 14th was Michael Waltrip. 15th was Elliott Sadler. 16th, Lance Norwick. 17th, as we watch the 24 on pit road, was Ron Hornaday. 18th was Brendan Gaughan. 19th was Butch Gilliland, and in 20th was the 67 of Scott Gaylord. Alan Bestwick.
Watching Jeff Gordon get four tires, pulling a spring rubber out of the left rear on his machine. The car a little bit tight after that aerodynamic damage he suffered in the earlier crash. Let's go up pit road to Steve Burns.
And Mike Skinner just stopped and took four tires, Alan, as did Jeremy Mayfield. 40 car of Sterling Marlin. They're also changing four tires. Last time they stopped, many teams took two. Now they're going back to four-tire strategy.
You see Gordon back out. This is the fifth caution that we have been under since this race got underway shortly after 12:30 here in Japan. Later in the evening in the United States. Hey, what a way to finish the season and finish off a Saturday night into Sunday morning. We'll take a quick break and be back. Tell you more about who is retired from the event and more of the story in just a moment. Yeah, it's time for a cup of coffee out here or something a little more strong. Sure, that's what it looks like. Hey, everybody's a racer here. Even the mayor comes out and races at Motegi. He races on the dirt, of course. No, that's not the main highway, buddy. Just feels like it when you're in that bus. 10 o'clock at night, headed back to the hotel.
Boy, I tell you what, though, it's beautiful coming up this hill towards the speedway.
As long as you don't have to drive. It's wonderful to ride, but you don't want to be driving a rental car in Japan.
200 feet of fill up there to that entryway, and take a look at the top 20 here. We can give you this. See Michael Waltrip back there in 10th. We've been reviewing this for you a moment ago. Bill Elliott, 9th. And we have 22 cars in the lead lap as you look at this rundown. You saw who came out of the pits first. See Scott Gaylord back there in the 20th position. I can give you a couple more that are a lap down as well at this point. The 58 of Craven has gone a lap down. They'll show him in 23rd, and 24th would be Ron Burns' car. Now, there you see Craven back in for another set of tires. They got five sets for this race.
Boy, Rusty Wallace's crew did a great job getting him out there in the lead right now. Mike Skinner was leading as they started in the 12 there. Jeremy Mayfield, they were running away with it, but Rusty Wallace got a great pit stop.
He sure did, and I think Alan Bestwick has got a story that goes right along with that.
Yeah, Ken, talking about the fact that we're far from home and at the end of the season, and not all of these race teams are here with their normal complement of people. You mentioned Rusty Wallace's team. Well, they've got the normal over-the-wall gang for the Penske South team. But Jeff Gordon's crew, for example, only has two of the normal guys who go over the wall to change the tires and jack the car and so on. So they're kind of a mix-and-match crew here from various Hendrick Motorsports department this weekend. And they lost a couple of spots on that stop, whereas normally they've been one of the best in the business all season long at gaining spots on pit road.
78th lap, and we're about to go green once again. Wilburn, Pemberton, Barvin, Armstrong, Thousand, Tracy, and Gaffara, that pit crew for Rusty Wallace that gave him first place. Give them a nod of the hat. Number 8 hanging tough on the outside, Jeff Davis.
He brought three cars over here. Two of the Japanese drivers are running cars that Davis owns.
Yeah, well, they were.
Yeah.
Mike Skinner on the move on the outside. You see Rusty Wallace move over there, taking that spot away. He didn't want him to pass him going down in the corner. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in third right there. He's got a mirror full of Jeff Burton as they head down towards the front straightaway.
Skinner to the inside, and here he comes. And with him comes Dale Earnhardt Jr. This is a battle for the lead. The kid's going to try to put it on him. He goes into second spot. Earnhardt Jr. picking up.
All clear.
Don't want to say right where Dale left off. That'll infuriate him. But I'll tell you, here he comes battling for the lead.
And not
too far back is Senior, although Jeff Gordon goes underneath him. And he brings Mayfield with him. So, here's the circumstance. Gordon is in fifth. Mayfield comes to sixth. At number three, as it comes to the line, Earnhardt finds himself in seventh. Darrell Waltrip, number 88, in eighth.
Burton looking extremely strong as he comes out of the second turn. Getting up a good head of steam to get out on the backstretch.
Right now, he just made a move into second place there. You see Rusty Wallace on the outside.
Clear.
Jeff Gordon looked like he shot out of a rocket. His as he goes by the two of Rusty Wallace.
Rusty's been dropping back
inside,
since the drop
inside.
Of the green.
24's got
Gordon
company.
To the inside. Gordon coming through. There's back to the three
inside.
Wide or trying to. Wallace
two,
coming
inside.
Down.
24.
Gordon has the edge. This is one of the battles everybody's been waiting for. Earnhardt Jr. goes in a little deeper than Gordon.
There.
Stuck
go
it
there.
In there.
Inside.
And he held him off.
Clear.
How
all clear.
About that? The Grand National
all
champion
clear.
Facing off with a Winston Cup champion.
Inside again.
Toe
he's
to
inside.
Toe.
To your door. To your door.
Those spotters are so cool. To the door, to the door. Yeah, right. 185
DJB's
miles an hour
inside,
he's in your door.
Car
Gordon's there. Here comes Wallace with him.
Got one with him.
Gordon to third. Wallace fighting for fourth with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
All clear. Coming back inside. Inside. Inside.
I hope nobody ever calls that kid Little Dave.
Got the 12 with him.
There's
12
nothing little about this talent.
Well, he's fixing to get
that
a dose to his father. If you notice the
yep.
three cars moving
go
into
there.
The four cars
go there.
Here.
Clear. All clear.
So demeaning. And he is so strong. Look at him. Stick it in there. Down to the inside.
Still all
comes
clear.
That number 12. And you've got those
Penske Kranepas
cars
all
side
clear.
By
all
side
clear.
In their own war. A sandwich between a pair of Earnhardts. How would you like to be sandwiched between a pair of Earnhardts?
No, thank
no,
you.
No, thank you is right.
Well, whatever adjustments they made to Dale Earnhardt Sr. car, he is really sticking well on the bottom side as he and Rusty Wallace
we'll
fight.
We'll get a chance to get back up there. Don't need to push. Don't
Earnhardt
need to
Sr. trying to muster some extra strength to come beneath Wallace. Got him.
Clear. Clear.
Lap 82. Earnhardt picks it up another notch. Coming around to complete lap number 83.
Trouble.
Oh, we got trouble in turn four. Stash one of the wall.
We're
on
the 88.
Car to high side of the wall. Turn
Darryl
four.
Waltrip. Darryl Waltrip and the Robert Yates, number 88. Well, a lot of people thought could maybe win this race today in the wall.
Tremendous amount of damage to the right front corner of that race car.
And you know his heart has sunk. Well, it always gets back. It is tough as you get older. And you know the statistics on Earnhardt Sr. in the last 4 or 5 years indicate that. The same thing for Waltrip. It's hard. And you can see this young, new talent. Elliott Sadler, Jeff Burton, Dale Earnhardt Jr. just strutting their stuff out here today.
You can see Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car right there has a little damage on the right side of it also.
Back toward the tail end here.
Yeah,
that, good bit of damage back
that
there.
That polar bear got deferred.
That little white Coca-Cola bear is not feeling as well as he did when this thing started. That's the
Dad,
right symbol
you
for today.
Kind of slow down, pull over so you can look at your right front for you.
Replay. Buddy.
Oh, you can see Bobby Hamilton gets in the back of Darryl Waltrip as they go down in the corner. Darryl loses the back of the car and he goes back up the racetrack. You'll see the left rear go up, up, up. And right into the wall.
Hard to say what really shorted that because we couldn't really see what was behind Hamilton.
Look at the back end of this number 88.
Yeah, Darryl definitely had help into the wall.
This is as good a NASCAR Super Speedway race as you could hope to see this year. Only thing missing is to have Mike Helton have to get down there and separate a couple of pit crews that get a little overzealous about this thing. Let's go down a pit road.
Well, the news is not good for Darryl Waltrip, Ken. You could see the crew around the right side of the car. The right front tire was wobbling. I'm not sure that there's not some significant suspension damage there. Right now, they're trying to get a look underneath things. If you look at the rear sheet metal, the left rear corner of the car is bent over. That means there's some pretty good damage on the right side as well. And so they're going to be here, either here or behind the wall for a little while to get that forward rolling back in a proper direction.
Checking on the lap count here in a moment, buddy.
You can see Todd Parrott, the crew chief, telling him, take it behind the wall. The damage is to the point that they can't fix it right away. They're going to have to work on it if they do indeed plan to come back into the race.
And spoilers all loose. The whole truck deck is loose in the back end, and those spoilers are so important at this speed. Pace car brings Mike Skinner by in the lead, number 31, last year's winner at Suzuka, and right behind him becomes that sensational Jeff Burton in the 99. Then you've got the defending Winston Cup champion, youngest
Three-time winner in history. Jeff Gordon is right there. And Earnhardt Jr. There's the lad. Get ready. He is. Jr. ready to go from fourth. That's after 86 laps. And we're getting close to the halfway mark. Approximately 100. Darrell Waltrip, moments ago with Stevie. Short day. Someone rapping, gently tapping on the back of the 88 door.
The number,
and it
the
was
one
the guy
car?
That used to idolize him.
That's all right. Never mind. I thought I was
the guy that
there.
Was his idol for Bobby Hamilton. Darrell Waltrip just barely nudged him going into turn number four. And you saw the results. 88 caved in. He's out of the race. Stevie there to give him support as she has through all of these years, through the championships, the good years, and the lean ones.
Caution car off the speedway. They're coming down for the green flag.
Lap 87 as they come back with the green. 134.7 complete. Skinner leads him down. Jeff Burton stays right there in second. Gordon third. And maintaining fourth is the number one. Earnhardt Jr. getting past. Mayfield on the inside. Got it.
Not only that, just behind him is Rusty Wallace on the left rear quarter.
Inside,
they head
clear.
Off the corner here. Rusty trying to make a pass on Junior
all
as they
clear,
come down the front
clear.
Straightaway.
Junior's having trouble keeping that car down. Has been having that problem since the last pit stop.
On this restart, Hamilton is eighth. Elliott is in ninth. And Sterling Marlin, tenth. With 11th belonging to Kenny Wallace and 12th to Michael Waltrip. Here
inside.
Comes Rusty
clear
Wallace.
Behind him. Clear behind him.
Number two is there. Not for long.
Dale Earnhardt Sr. there in the three car, moving right in on his son's back bumper as they head down into turn one. Now you can watch the one car right here. He's got a terrible push.
For the lead. Jeff Burton down to the inside of the 99. Cold tires or no, he's there, and here comes Gordon into second. And Skinner, in less than 500 feet, falls back to third. Mayfield fourth. Alan Bestwick standing by with Darrell Walker.
Well, Darrell is watching the race continue without him. Darrell, to pull out an old cliche, it sure was good while it lasted.
Well, yeah, I hate it. The last thing I wanted to do was wreck the car, you know. I had a great car. I really was just riding. We have overdriving the car, and I hadn't really used shifting much. And talking to Todd, getting the car better as we went along, trying to be there at the end to win the race. Bobby's on the same flight I am going home, and it's, you know, about a 14-hour ride. He'll be pretty miserable all the way home, I can promise you that.
All right, Darrell's
still. All right, Darrell. Well, DW says he's going to come back and race some more next year, and possibly the year after that, thinks he's going to deal locked up to try to Ford next year. Meanwhile, look at this dog fight.
Yeah. Jeff Gordon in the 24 there goes right by Jeff Burton. It looked like he was on a rail when he went by on the low side. But Jeremy Mayfield has closed in on both these guys.
Pulls away by six car lengths. Gordon doing what he's done all year. 13-time winner. Rewrote the record book at that time. And will stand center stage in the Waldorf Astoria again this season. And here they come. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Dale Earnhardt Sr. Ladies and gentlemen, Winston Cup Racing's in great shape.
There's damage to the back of Earnhardt Jr.'s car. You can see the rear bumper there flapping in the breeze, looking back at his father in the three car.
You don't think he's just waving to him?
I don't think so.
That's got to be quite an experience for dad to be watching his kid up in front.
I've never seen Earnhardt more mellow, more human, and than when his son won that first Grand National.
35-80.
He was so blown away. Remember that Daytona afternoon in the 300 down there? And he just walked in and gave him a hug and immediately got out of victory lane. It was not Earnhardt Sr.'s victory lane, and he wasn't going to be part of Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s party. He just wanted to support him.
Bobby
Earnhardt Sr. is something.
Bobby Hamilton just behind these two as they go at it in the four car there, moving in.
Alan Bestwick on Earnhardt Jr.
Well, Ken, that damage you were looking at the right
80.
Rear corner of Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car is not what they're concerned about. He got tagged by somebody else in one of those earlier stack-ups. What they are concerned about is on that last restart when he was racing Mike Skinner for the lead. He scuffed the wall with the right side of the car coming off turn number four, set up a big cloud of smoke. They're afraid it might have affected the handling on the car just a little bit.
Whoops. And you're going to have a lot of whoops. It is getting cooler. Halfway. Halfway coming up this time. Halfway on the event. 201 makes it. They're not going to give the flag at midway down the backstretch, so they'll knock it off here at 100. 201 laps will make the distance.
What a year Earnhardt Jr. has had. Turned 24 on October 10th. Won 7 times this year in that series. That's more than anybody. Won 3 poles, more than anybody. Led the most laps, most races. Won the championship in his rookie year.
Clear.
He's getting it done this afternoon, too, isn't he?
Absolutely, and was leading the last race there at Homestead and had an engine problem. But I tell you, this kid's for real. You can see right now he has great talent in his first full year of Busch Grand National Racing to win the championship.
He's in 6th. His dad is in 7th. Bobby Hamilton is in 8th.
When I was there at Homestead, and when that kid climbed out of the car and stood on top of it, man, the grandstand went wild. You could hear it over the top of the engines, all those engines, and you could hear the crowd roar for young Dale Earnhardt Jr.
'99 is fixing to be some year. This Jeff Burton in the '99 and Jeff Gordon back trying to win a national title for the 4th time. What a story there. 2 men in the history of the game have won it 7. The King, Richard Petty, and the Intimidator, Earnhardt Sr. And as the world turns, there's that number 24 of Jeff Gordon out in front with that 99, Jeff Burton. 2-time winner this year, Jeff Burton. My, you're going to hear a lot about that Virginia kid in time to come. Alive, and we were given some misinformation. We were told we were at halfway. We are at halfway at this point. Cross flags are out. They had told us 5 laps ago that we were at halfway. That was incorrect. Again, we have no scoring here. The track scoring went out. NASCAR scoring hasn't worked with it. So you got to live with us on this one, fans. Jeff Gordon, no doubt about it, has the lead, and Jeff Burton is in 2nd as we get to halfway in this million-dollar race at Motegi, coming to you live on a Saturday night, Sunday morning. In the United States, Sunday afternoon here in Japan. There's the 99, and that is Jeff Burton, 2nd place car, honoring Bruce Lee. 1st and 2nd, let's go to Steve Burns.
And Ken, we're with Frankie Stoddard, the crew chief on the 99. Frank, that car looks like it's really getting through the corners good. What is Jeff saying about the car?
The car's a little bit tight right now, you know. The Bruce Lee car has been running good all weekend here. We qualified well. That was a change for us, and looks like we're going for the lead here right now. But you know, Jeff's been doing a great job, and we're really honored this weekend to be over here in Japan with Twin Ring Motegi, and to be carrying the Bruce Lee colors, you know, in his honor, is a great experience. The Japanese people have welcomed us with open arms, and we hope that we can bring this thing home in victory lane today. I don't know.
Best of luck.
Thanks.
Did he say hi?
For a guy from North April, New Hampshire, he's really getting into it here. Frankie Stoddard, crew chief for that number 99, honoring Bruce Lee 25 years ago. We lost Bruce Lee. His films are so popular still, and they are the most popular here in Japan. And there's that dragon, the Bruce Lee dragon, up on the hood of that thing. And that dragon has roared big time.
Well, they better roar, because just behind our 2nd place runner there, Jeff Gordon, Mike Skinner is really closing in.
Yep. You've got him in 1st. The 99 is there at halfway. Out of South Boston, Virginia. I bet his dad is tickled right now, watching as Jeff continues to put it on. 5 wins in Winston Cup racing. This may be a non-point race, but this is an all-for-it race. Record book. That's what counts here. Somebody's going to come out and be remembered in history.
Ken,
winning the 1st super speedway race outside of the United States.
Are you to the point that $150,000 means zero to you?
Well, I mean, these days in Winston Cup, $6 million what Gordon earned this year.
Boy, let me tell you, $150,000 is still a lot of money, believe me.
Well, when you divvy it all up, get them all over here. Those tickets over here don't come cheap.
I'll tell you what you're watching here this afternoon to a degree is the changing of the guard. You saw the graphic.
Changing of the lead.
Yeah, you saw the graphic a minute ago about Burton being 31 years old. Gordon's 27 years old. Right now, Jeremy Mayfield is riding in fourth spot. He's 29 years old. The kids are coming, and they're running up front.
That looked like Mark Martin's move there for Jeff Burton, just pulling over to the left and letting Gordon go out there and run right at the moment. He just pulled over, said, go on up there and lead for a couple laps. But you see Mike Skinner there running in third, closing in on both these guys.
162 and a half miles have been completed with 105 laps.
Take a look at the last couple of lead changes in this one.
There's Gordon as he scooted around on the outside.
Jeff Burton there in the 99 goes down into turn three. You can see much quicker. Jeff Gordon's car pushes out in the center part of the corner. He says, see you later, as he goes right around on the bottom part of the racetrack.
And then Gordon on the way by. Gordon's car seems none the worse for wear. Despite all that body damage he's got on the automobile, it doesn't seem to have hurt his performance at all.
Now here's Burton being exiled back to second spot by about 10 car lengths this time, as Gordon really got the jump on it. But you're right, buddy. The story's back there in that third spot. That car is coming fast. There's Gordon's numbers. 42 wins, 31 of them on the super speedways and the short tracks where he grew up. 8 3 road races. Not bad for kid still in his 20s.
About a 27-year-old guy with 33 wins in the past 3 years.
Veteran. Gordon in first and in pursuit. The 99. You're there. You're riding with him.
There's Jeff Burton. Very easy on the throttle as he comes out there. You can see slower cars as they start by, putting these guys a lap down. If you ever get out the throttle, you lose a lot of straightaway speed as Jeff Burton is checking him over again as Gordon moves up to the high side of the racetrack.
And tries him on the inside for the lead. You're with Jeff Burton as he goes right back in front live at Motegi. Burton, the Virginia kid, puts the X-side colors back up on top.
And just a mirror behind these guys, Mike Skinner's moved right in on the back bumper of Jeff Gordon.
The persistence, the patience of these two as they work each other over. And here comes Skinner into the picture. A three-way battle. After having a sensational season in 98, we asked Jeff Gordon to put in perspective on how he felt about his great run this year.
This has been an unbelievable year. I mean, there's no other way to describe it. And I don't really know if it's quite sunk in just how incredible the year has been. And someday I can't wait to look back on everything and say, man, 1998, boy, it doesn't get any better than that. And I'll be surprised if it ever does get any better than it has been this year.
Well, it sure can't get much better than that. He's had 13 wins, 6 seconds, and 33 starts. That's a 57% first or second place average. Folks, you can't get any better than that. The word awesome is not strong enough to describe the year that young man and his team have had.
Front three have drawn away by about a second and a half, maybe 2 seconds. With 90 laps to go to decide this one. Gordon is back. Another challenge, another try.
That 24 looks like an old Rocky movie. He's got his face all beat up, but I tell you what, he's going at it pretty well as he goes by Jeff Burton down in the corner. You can see right here as they go in, the 24 moves up just a little bit. Jeff Burton turns to the inside, gets a great run up out of the corner.
The throttle control of that kid Burton has made the difference. So he's so strong on a mile and a half track. And look at these two still. Nose to nose here at Motegi.
All is back and forth. Kid, I don't think they've hit each other yet.
They're getting ready.
And look at, here comes Skinner. Here he comes.
Mike Skinner on the inside.
I want a piece of this. Behind this group, Mayfield lies fourth. In fifth is Rusty Wallace. In sixth, Earnhardt Jr. In seventh, Earnhardt Sr. In eighth is Bobby Hamilton. In ninth is Bill Elliott. In tenth is the number 40 of Sterling Marlin. In 11th, Michael Waltrip. In 12th would be Kenny Wallace. Then in 13th is Elliott Sadler. In 14th is Jeff Davis. In 15th, Lance Norwich. 17th is gone. That doesn't mean it's disappeared out of here. That's Brendan gone. Following him is the number 16. That's gone. Then the 67 of Scott Gaylord. Getting you back to, and they're all in that lead lap. Laps winding down. The end of that, getting up toward the last third of this race. As you look here, you can see that number 12 working his way around. And here's the 31, Skinner, trying to get his way back up on this one.
Well, that was an awesome shot looking back out of Jeff Burton's car. That's Ricky Craven there being pushed behind the wall.
A tough way to start a deal with a new team. He's had a rough ride here this afternoon. I'll tell you what, if this race doesn't make a whole bunch of stock car fans in Japan, nothing could. It's been as good a stock car race as there has been all year long.
Up on the outside around some lap cars. For the first time on a super speedway. In Japan, Thornton flips it a little closer to the inside and moves back up, having fallen to third on Mike Skinner in second.
You see that whole right side of Mike Skinner's car there? That's held together by what we call 200-mile-an-hour tape. They made a side for that car, beat it out, put tape over it, went back out about 15 minutes after they crashed, went back out there, and was second fastest in practice.
Yeah, no spare cars here. Everybody had just one car, whatever they could put in one of those seagoing containers. They'd have gone to a spare car if it was in the U.S. Look at Gordon again on the bottom.
You can see the right side there. Right now, he's fighting an arrow push in a big way in the 31 car. Mike Skinner cannot keep that car down as Jeff Gordon makes a move on the inside.
Steve Burns is with Ricky Craven, who's not having a happy time in Japan.
No, Ken, a short afternoon for Ricky Craven. Boy, I watched you guys on pit road fight it. What actually put you out?
I think a wheel bearing in the left front. I got together with Junior on a restart, and it hit the left front, messed the fender up a little, but it was still a nice opportunity for us. A new team, Turbine Solutions, wonderful group. A little bit of an exhibition for us as a new team, but really enjoyed this trip also. You know, wonderful culture over here. These people are very hospitable, and they love what we do, this NASCAR race, and they welcomed us. Enjoyed it.
All right, Ricky had some great runs at the end of the year in the 36 car, full-time ride for 99.
So the 99, Jeff Burton. Craven would like to be where he was a lot of that road race a year ago at Suzuka. Here comes Gordon again. Need some lap traffic to work his way under.
You can see the lap traffic working very, very well with the leader there, Jeff Burton. Instead of going down into the bottom side of the racetrack, the preferred line, they move to the outside of the racetrack and give the guys that are fighting for the lead the inside of the racetrack to run fast.
And this pair is pulling away now from Mike Skinner. We'll take a commercial break and be back, catch you up to date again. Again, we're having a little problem. Scoring doesn't exist here today, so we'll just keep the old lap chart going. In Motegi, Japan, coming to you live on TBS. And they're loving it. Yep, I don't know how many lead changes, and we say the scoring is out, but the story is right up here in front as Jeff Gordon, for the moment, has the advantage. They have worked this lead back and forth. Got a pretty good battle for ninth, we're being told. Let's take a look back there. There you see Sterling Marlin. With him comes Michael Waltrip. Here's Kenny Wallace down the inside. That Sterling Marlin car is in eighth, followed by, and let me recheck that now. Eighth, ninth, seventh is moving up. Michael Waltrip gaining some positions out here as he closes on the 40.
changes and color changes and crew changes. Yeah, but it seems to be more this year than it has been before. Maybe it's a reflection. Yeah, I think it's a reflection of the pressure that's on these people to win. Seems if any team that didn't win a race this year, the crew chief's gone, driver's gone, sponsors moving somewhere else. Everybody wants to win, but only one team can do it on any given Sunday.
We're being told 19 lead changes among six drivers thus far, and that's through 126 laps, 195 miles, ready to enter that last third of this one. 311 miles makes the distance, 500 kilometers for $1 million here at Motegi. 640 acres to develop this track. Sheared off the top of three mountains. Built this thing up about 200 feet, 175 feet, probably is a better number. And built this facility, built a three-mile track road course. You can see one of the tunnels there. They go through turn three beneath that third turn. And decided to build a super speedway as well. And they built a grand one. Winston West comes here to race next year. And there'll be some marquee players as well, telling us, that will also join the crowd. That'll be a big step forward as NASCAR moves into the Pacific.
Michael Waltrip into the pits. That is a bit of a surprise. And the number seven, he was right in the battle with Sterling Marlin, who you see on your screen right now.
Bobby Hamilton is line eight, and at the present time we have in ninth, Bill Elliott in tenth. Sterling Marlin, that number 40, is brought back a little. And running 11th was the number seven, the Michael Waltrip, now on pit road. With that move onto pit road by Waltrip, the number 55 is Waltrip comes back out. Kenny Wallace picks up the spot. 130, we are being told, is now the completion number. 130. So that gets us down to 71 laps remaining.
Boy, Jeff Gordon could not get by the lap car there and lost a lot of momentum. You can see that Jeff Burton closed in to about a 10-car length advantage right now that Jeff Gordon has as they come off turn two and down the back straightaway.
Lapping Fukuyama that time as he came back.
Earnhardt Jr. in the pits. You're with him.
Green flag stops. After all these cautions, what are we up to, six or eight? Anyway, let's go down there.
Stop at lap 131, Ken, is really going to set up a curious situation on fuel mileage if we don't get a caution for the rest of the race. Two tires only for Earnhardt Jr. They load it up on fuel.
4,000.
Out he goes, giving him the warning on the pit road speed limit, making sure they don't get brought back in for a penalty.
So this is the first time we've seen him in. That polar bear seems right at home on the number one car as he comes out. He likes this weather.
It's cold out there.
Started at 53 degrees and it dropped out in the 50s. It's down some more. We're 60 miles to the north and west of Tokyo here at Motegi, Japan.
I'm just watching Mike Skinner there, the third car, as he closes in. He's changed his line a little bit to accommodate the pushing that he had in that race car. He's diamond in the corner now. Goes down low and lets the front end of the car go up the hill just a little bit. Right now, as I said that, he hugs that white line like he owns it.
He has just become a much, much smarter race car driver this year. A lot of that can be attributed to Larry McReynolds, who talks to him on the radio on a regular basis. And Mike Skinner's learned that he can't always run with the pedal on the floor. He's got to be careful.
Let's listen to him as he starts out of the corner here. Right now, getting by the 99 there. Jeff Burton takes over second place back to the bottom. Let's listen at him come off turn two. You could hear him out of the throttle several times there to let the front end settle and get good grip as he was headed towards the back straightaway.
Rusty Wallace on pit road in number two. Wallace running in seventh when he pitted. Just in front of him was Earnhardt Sr.
Here comes Gordon down pit road as well, and
here
Jeff
comes
Burton.
The gang. These two, the 99 and the 28, now coming on to pit road. These two fighters have fidgeted with the lead over the last 100 miles. Let's go down there to Jeff Gordon's pits right now.
Remember that Gordon's crew is mostly substitutes. Burton's crew, most of their regular pit crew. Let's see how it plays out. Right side tires on the Gordon car. They'll come around to the left and change all four. Down the pit road to Jeff.
effort to stop.
And Alan Frankensteiner told me they only have three members of their normal over-the-wall gang. They're changing right side tires, no chassis adjustments, to the 99 of Jeff Burton. Crew chief Frankie Stoddard on the left rear. Four tires stopped, no chassis adjustments for Jeff Burton. 19.8 seconds.
There's the race back on the track, and they're still together. Gordon and Burton are still at it here. Mayfield also pitted at that same moment.
John, Mayfield had trouble getting off pit road. The crew had to push him. He's lost valuable position on the racetrack as a result.
Side clear. Clear all around. No pressure.
So we'll pick up on new leaders. And let's see. We've had the 24 in, the 99. Did we see 31 in yet? I don't believe so.
Not yet.
So he's the leader. There's your leader, Mike Skinner. And that means that into second place, with Wallace going, would be Earnhardt Sr.
And Skinner's got virtually his entire pit crew that won that pit crew championship at Rockingham just a couple of weeks ago. The front carrier, Kevin Gabbard, he's gone. He's in surgery. But other than that, they've got their regular crew there.
One thing about Larry McReynolds, the crew chief on the 31 car, he's going to keep him out there. As I say that, he comes right down pit road. That's as far as he could go on fuel.
Well, this is one of the best crews in all of Winston Cup Racing about to service Mike Skinner's race car. Ron Otto, the rear changer. This is his last race with this team. He's one of the most important people on this pit stop.
This is happening to lap 138 of 201 to be run. Lap 138.
You know, a lot of people wonder why he come into pits and turn back out like that, so he never gets caught in the pits where he can't get out. He's got the nose headed out so nobody can block him in.
Steve Burns with Bill Elliott's car.
Side 99.
Yeah, they're going to make a chassis adjustment to the right rear, Ken. They also pulled off one of the tearaway windshield visors to improve his vision. Coming to the left side of the car for Bill Elliott. Again, a chassis adjustment to the right rear. Left side tires going on for Bill Elliott.
Earnhardt is on pit road. Right side rubber on the number three. That old Coke machine handled the lead for about three laps. Now he comes in for a four-tire change.
Look at that black mark just in front of the right front wheel there. That's brake dust. They're using a lot of brake on this three car. You can see it right there.
Clear rim. Get all you can.
Don't use much going into turn one, but they sure use them going into three, don't they, buddy?
Oh, boy. You can see quite a bit there. So he's laying on the brakes going into turn three, as you said, Doc.
Sadler, the 21 car, coming back out again. And this is the leader. With this round of pit stops, first time these Japanese fans, after those six cautions early. Ooh, look at this.
That's a battle for third there. You can see Earnhardt Jr. on the bottom side of Rusty Wallace as they fight down the front straightaway. Anybody that thinks this kid's along for the ride, just watch this.
I was going to say, do you think this kid will amount to much, Baker?
Oh, boy. What a franchise driver he's going to be.
Yeah, you notice how quick his dad snatched him up and signed him to a long-term contract. He wasn't going to let anybody get him. This is one of the most talented young race drivers in America
all
today.
Clear.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. swarming all over. Rusty Wallace in the deuce, and here comes Wallace back. One of the great veterans, former Winston Cup champion, going toe-to-toe with the kid.
Inside, all by himself.
Well, the way Rusty Wallace came off that corner, you can see the Earnhardt driving very, very hard.
Door, all by himself, cleared up behind him.
Makes you wonder how good Earnhardt Jr. is going to be when he gets more experience.
I don't think he needs a whole lot of experience right now. What they're looking forward to is building their own cars the next year and making the adjustments to the cars, like their Busch Grand National car they ran this year.
Now we're being told with that tire change, that 31 still has first place. Mike Skinner still up in front.
Let's take a ride with Dale Jr. and listen as he goes around the corner. Right now, he's not able to keep the race car on the bottom of the racetrack like he wants to.
fastest part of the racetrack right there, and then you can hear it idle way back, buddy. They get down there in three.
Yeah, he's
hard on the brake.
I tell you something else, he used every inch of that racetrack up coming out of turn two over there. He does have a little bit of push. You can see almost 9,000 down the straightaway on the RPMs there.
They're telling us that Earnhardt Jr. is in fourth. Dan Skinner with that pit stop. Creditable one. Lets him retain the lead over Gordon in second. And Jeff Burton in third.
Skinner having a big afternoon. 1 year last year in Japan on the road course. Looking awful good this afternoon. Or tonight if you're watching this in the United States.
There it is around Butch Gillen, 1997 Winston West champion. Remember, Winston West comes here next year, plus some marquee stars from NASCAR. Quick break, and then be back with you again. There's your top five. Motegi, Japan.
Which way do you go?
Just go down to the corner and take a left.
Oh, please.
There is Larry McReynolds, pride and joy, out in front here in that 31. Stays up. 149, as we understand. Laps complete. Mike Skinner with a brilliant pit stop, able to stay in front of Jeff Gordon by how much on your watch?
A little over a second the last time around. He's opening it up, though.
Let's find out more about that stop by the 31. Steve Burns is with Larry McReynolds.
And he's talking to his driver, Mike Skinner. Larry, what adjustments did you make that time, and can you make it the distance on fuel?
Yeah, we can make it the distance. You know, the thing about it, it's really cold today, and the more rubber gets on the track, the tighter it gets. So we made some pretty major adjustments, because that's probably our last set of tires, caution or green, so we'll see what happens.
Okay, thanks, Larry. He's busy talking to his driver, Mike Skinner, as he winds down the laps.
The old student of racing, Larry McReynolds. You saw him early. He joined us here on TBS on that 747 on his way over. Worked the entire way over. I went back and asked him, is he working on Sunday? He said, oh, no, I'm working on 1999. Now, there's first. Now, here's your second-place car. That's the interval of Jeff Gordon in second. They put a lap on Fukuyama in the 98. He straggles along at the bottom of the track, two or three laps down.
You can see right there the interval. That's your first place car right there, Jeff Gordon. And just behind him, Jeff Burton there on the inside, the 99 car.
Yeah, that interval has doubled. It's 2.06 seconds now.
Jeff Burton back there in third, and that's the view from Jeff Burton's car as he rotates around turns one and two. It's almost like a tightening radius down there in three. You go in, you get in the brakes, you got to make a cut, and then you got to make a second cut. They really get it into turn four, and you're coming in there at what, 185, 190, buddy?
I'd say at least that, and the speeds here are very similar to maybe a Charlotte before they repaved the racetrack there, and they got a tremendous amount of speed going into just 17 degrees of banking compared to 24 degree banking in Charlotte.
One of the strategy points this afternoon is that they've got to preserve the front tires when they get on the brakes so hard. Getting into that tight third turn, it does take its toll on the front tires. And Skinner, among others, has said that may be the key to victory.
Earnhardt closes on Mayfield. Remember, Mayfield came in fourth place with that pit stop under green. And these Japanese fans have been treated to everything, all kinds of wild action. Now we've got a green flag stop. Seen some of the brilliance of these pit crews. They may not be at the full force they would be for a Daytona 500 or a Charlotte 600, but they certainly have accounted for themselves brilliantly here this afternoon. Caution.
Caution's out, Dale. It's in turn two. I think there's a car down on the low side, hardly moving.
Turn two, seventh caution of the day.
Well,
that number 26 again. Ron Burns may be the victim. Another time.
He's getting some TV time today, isn't he?
That's a hat trick, folks. That's three times, whatever happened. He's been involved with something three times today that brought out the caution.
I got to tell you, that does not hurt the friends of Ron Burns one bit. They wanted to see that vitamin car.
Except you can't read the sponsor.
It's been encapsulated in about 12-lap hops here thus far this afternoon.
Yeah, they got so much tape in the back, Ken, you can't read the sponsor.
12 cars in the lead lap, and let me go through them for you for a second here, catch you up to date on that. And again, scoring, OUT gone. 31 is your leader, Skinner. Now Gordon right up there behind him, followed by Jeff Burton. And then you have the number two of Rusty Wallace in fourth. Following in fifth is Dale Earnhardt Jr. In sixth is the number 40 of Marlin. Then in seventh is Michael Waltrip. In eighth would be Jeremy Mayfield. In ninth is Earnhardt Sr. In tenth is Hamilton. 11th is Elliott. And riding 12th would be Elliott Sadler. Those are in the lead lap. That was at lap 153 of the 201 to be run. 236, almost 237 miles complete. About 74 miles to go. Buddy?
Doctor, I got to wonder if anybody's going to come in. There's a bunch of them that were worried about whether they could go to the distance. As I say that, here comes a few cars down pit road.
Rusty Wallace is one of them.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. there in the one car coming in to top off.
I want to thank Robin Stumm and Gail Connors, who've done just a terrific job in trying to keep us up to date on the scoring here today. Been a little different. Here's Alan Bestwick on the one car.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. got just right side tires on his last stop. He was one of the first leaders to pit under the green flag cycle. He could not make the finish on fuel. This caution, a big break for him. Four tires on the Earnhardt Jr. car.
Alan, Jeremy Mayfield takes just two tires and makes a chassis adjustment to the right side. Rusty Wallace also on pit road further down, as well as Bobby Hamilton.
We'll take a break and return live to Motegi. The NASCAR stars putting on some show here in their first race on a super speedway in Japan.
Hey, race fans, Budweiser asks, who won November 22nd, 1997, Suzuka Circuit? Qualifying for the NASCAR Thunder Special was held in rainy conditions, and Dale Earnhardt in car number three was the early leader for the top spot. Four-time road course pole sitter Mark Martin in car number six focused on taking that top spot away. Australian road racing champion Jim Richards in car 09 surprised the Winston Cup regulars with his outstanding qualifying effort. But who took the pole position? Take a look at the contenders. The answer is coming
Thursday.
And the rain was Mark Martin. His wet weather run put him on the pole for the second running of the NASCAR Thunder Special in Suzuka. Who won was brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers. This Bud's for you.
And there are American fans here at Motegi, Japan. I guess we know who they're for. 1998 champion will stand on the stage at the Waldorf Astoria to celebrate a spectacular season. Number 24, Jeff Gordon.
And the third time also.
Getting ready for a go as they line them up. Crank them for another go. What is this, lap 160? 159. Coming around for lap 160. Auto restart.
All right,
see Michael Waltrip down to the bottom. He is the lap down. For a moment, they had him riding in fourth. Didn't seem right. Sure enough, he pulled down or he belonged. And
Kenny Wallace there, a lap down also on the inside.
Here comes Mike Skinner leading the pack. Getting down to decision time. 80-foot wide straightaway. Live from Motegi. We're underway another time.
Wow, somebody better make a decision in a hurry. They were four wide going down in the corner just now.
Michael was making a serious effort at getting his lap back. It didn't work.
Earnhardt's number three up on that high side. Average qualifying speed, what, was around 156?
You're riding with Dale Earnhardt Jr. You see Rusty Wallace in the two there, going by Sterling Marlin in the 40 on the outside. They go down towards the back straightaway,
still
side
there.
By side.
Still there. Still
Earnhardt
out there.
Jr. edging along on the bottom.
Hard to believe that young man had only won four.
Clear.
What is it? Won four races prior to the 1998 season, and those were all minor league races.
Marlon Luce.
Elliott Sadler helped make him loose as they went in the corner. Bobby Hamilton making it three wide down the front straightaway and into turn one.
That's for position two. What that's all about is fifth spot.
And Elliott Sadler played it smart. He backed out of that thing. He said that the yellow stripe at the back of his bumper means a lot to him. He doesn't want to make anybody mad. He says he wants to learn to race when he should race and back out of it when he shouldn't. It was one of those times it was smart to back out of it.
Here comes Elliott Sadler again. He's back up in the top 10. Here he comes as he makes a run on Sterling Marlin in the 40. Hey, what was it you said yesterday, buddy, about being on the edge?
I said, if you don't live on the edge, you're taking up too much space.
Yeah. Well, they're right out there, and nobody's taking up too much space among these leaders. Back in 1996, Tom Stinson of Winston Cup Scene came over here and posed the question, what are we doing, NASCAR in Japan? And he answered his own question. He said the answer came to him while he was sitting naked in a hot tub here with a bunch of strangers.
Please.
He said, we have decided to expose ourselves to another world. And we've dipped into what could become an extremely inviting exchange of cultures.
Folks, nobody did. And that they never said Ken Squire wasn't a sick man.
What a visual. No, that's what he said. But it sure is. These Japanese fans are getting a taste of NASCAR racing. Get a taste of hot tubs and great food, different than what you're used to back in the States.
I'll guarantee you on that one.
I'm not going near that hot tub thing, but boy, that Skinner is running. Look at him go.
161 complete. 249 miles down. And there you see Mike Skinner out of Susanville, California.
Yeah, that says no wins there, but as far as I'm concerned, he won that race last year by great driving over in Suzuka, Japan. Did a great job. And you can see very few races under his belt here in Winston Cup. He's going to be a major star.
Third twice this year, three top tens in his last five 1998 starts. He has really come on strong. The more time he spends with McReynolds, the better he gets. Suit trying to catch him.
Yeah, I think he's going to get a reality check here in just a few seconds, though. But Jeff Gordon right on that white line. You can see Skinner's car beginning to push up just a little bit in the center part of the corner.
Interval stays just about the same, that lap. What a change of seasons this has been. October and November, never very strong for Gordon this year. He just stuck it to him in those last races of the year.
These three guys, Doctor, I didn't mean to interrupt, but these three guys right here have raced each other so very, very hard today. Jeff Gordon right now seems to have the car that can run the white line better as he closes in to about a seven-car length advantage right now for the leader. But Jeff Gordon is coming. And Jeff behind him, Jeff Burton, what a great run he's had all day long. They've worked on that car, made adjustments on it. Running very, very well.
165 laps, 255 of the 311 miles. Give you a little bit of a leaderboard here, I believe. There's Mike Skinner, Jeff Gordon, Jeff Burton, Earnhardt, and Mayfield running in the top five. And then behind him, you have Rusty Wallace in six, Earnhardt Jr. in seven. Again, we're with you live. We have a 170-lap rundown upcoming for you. That's Mike Skinner after a brilliant pit stop under green. He's able to wrench the lead away, and here we got a change of position for second. It's Jeff Gordon falling back to third as Jeff Burton takes over another time up there in second spot. So Burton back to second. Let's see if he can close in on that leader, Mike Skinner. And for the moment, we'll go to Steve Burns.
Hey, Ken, it's time for an Auto Week Weekend Racing update. 1-800-232-1522 for a 52-week subscription at $19.95. Now for the news, Jeff Gordon has been named Driver of the Year for the third time. No big surprise there, but he edges out Alex Zanardi in drivers from all forms of motorsports. He becomes the third three-time recipient, joining Darrell Waltrip and Mario Andretti. And in Truck Series news, it was announced today that Mike Wallace, the driver of Ken Schrader's number 52 Chevy, will be leaving with crew chief Timmy Cahoot to drive for Team ASC, the number 2 truck. Wallace will replace Mike Bliss in that truck. Timmy Cahoot replaces Barry Dawson. And once again, that number, 1-800-232-1522, $19.95. Hey, that's the lowest price ever. Don't delay.
Well done, Bertie.
Wow.
Well, all that was,
tip your wafers.
Yeah, while all that was going on, Elliott Sadler went into the garage. He's behind the wall. Big belch of fire out of the thing as he got near his garage space. He's done.
Doctor, you could hear it when it caught by. It dropped the cylinder about 4 or 5 laps before that. Was trying to make it to the end of the race, and it just gave up the ghost right in front of us here on the front straightaway.
We're up towards 180, but on the 170-lap rundown, 263 miles, you had Bill Elliott running in the 10th position, and in 9th then was Earnhardt Jr., and up in 8th was Sterling Marlin, and in 7th was Hamilton. The front of the field had Mike Skinner leading, and at that moment, Gordon was in 2nd, but now there's been a change there, and once again, Jeff Burton is back on it. The Roush car, number 99, having a great day.
Ken, that is like watching the movie over and over. You see this every week. Jeff Burton drops back, comes forward, drops back, comes forward. Near the end of the race, that 99 car, if it's running, is always a car that these guys have to race at the end.
Well, that movie also has that 24 car able to close and do incredibly well at the end. How many times this year have we seen that car not be in the very front? But as the race goes on, checkered flag comes out. There he is.
On the 175-lap rundown, giving it to you unofficial, we have no scoring here today. 271 miles with Skinner in front. And then we had the 99 of Burton, followed by Gordon.
Ooh, that's gone. Exhaust pipe dragging right there. That's nothing to worry about. That's just the exhaust pipe has dropped down. They
on
got
the
a
16.
Little hanger under there, and the hanger's broken, and the exhaust pipe itself is dragging the racetrack.
That's on that Brian Gaughan car.
As long as it doesn't fall off.
Down. I bet they'll bring him in.
Yep. Yeah, I'd say the black flag is ready for him.
Little consultation coming up. In the fourth spot is Mayfield. In fifth is Wallace. Sixth is Earnhardt Sr. Seventh, Hamilton. Eighth, the number 94 of Elliott. And then in ninth was Dale Earnhardt Jr., followed by Sterling Marlin. Those are your top 10 with 175 miles complete. 271 miles. The end of the final moments. We'll be back for the finish here at Motegi live on TBS in a moment.
You know what?
180 lap rundown, 278.6 miles. Skinner, Burton, Gordon, Mayfield up there in front. And it looks like that number 99 is closing on that number 31. Maybe a car length or two every lap. What do you think, Doctor?
It's definitely closing. I've had the watch on him, and he's picking it up. He's picking it up very little each lap.
Last, leader about a 35.80.
You hear him. They're giving lap times every time. 35.80 is what they're turning the racetrack at right now.
Was that the voice of Larry Mack that I heard there? Keeping track, Larry McReynolds. That was him.
And I thought we were the leader. 10-4, second place.
Nice going, Burton. Nice going. I thought we were the leaders, says Jeff Burton. No, you got a little making up to do here to Skinner. Hey, Elliott Sadler's out of the race. Let's get the story right now from Steve Burns.
Elliott, your first excursion into Japan, and you're out before the race is over. What happened?
Well, we think we broke a valve spring or something like that in the motor. Just one of those things that happened. Maybe our Japanese setup didn't work too good a little bit over here, but looking forward to bright things. Had a great qualifying run this weekend with some lot of top-notch hitters in Winston Cup. We changed a lot on the car this morning trying to get this Sitco Ford a little bit better, but just didn't work out for us today, but we got some high hopes in front of us, a little work and a little studying to do, and hopefully we'll hit the ground when we get to Daytona running.
Most importantly, he's got his first experience with the Wood Brothers under his belt, but Elliott Sadler is going to be on the sidelines when the checker waves.
All right, thank you, Alan Bestwick. Steve was doing Auto Week. He was doing the interview there, and here's Baker. What do you think, buddy?
Well, I'm just watching Dale Earnhardt Jr. there. He's dropping back a little bit. I think now the Hamlin problem has gotten more significant on the one car as he drops back. Sterling Marlin a while ago was passed by Earnhardt Jr., but you can see the car going very high in the center part of the corner.
Meanwhile, the story for first place gets ever tighter. Yeah, it may be Skinner out in front, but up in second spot, creeping closer, is the 99. Now there's that number 40 of Sterling Marlin. He has picked himself up ninth, and back to 10th has fallen the number one of Earnhardt Jr.
Right now, Jeff Burton, right on that white line, is really reeling in the 31 of Mike Skinner, the race leader. It's down to about a six-car length advantage right now as Skinner goes off into turn one. You can see right now all that Mike Skinner can see is that 99 coming in the mirror.
Jeff Gordon stays there in
35-90. That was a little better even yet. 15 to go. 1-5-15.
That's the word from Larry McReynolds to his driver, Mike Skinner. Trying to hold on to this thing. Meanwhile, Jeff Burton closes in. 185 laps complete. 286 miles. There's Larry McReynolds trying to coach him on. Ooh.
You got to concentrate.
Big jump right there.
Right there, off turn four. Larry Mack's looking at him, shaking his head. He knows they're giving him the best run they can give him right now. Jeff Burton has gone into another zone here as far as the way he gets off turn four. Very fast off that area of the racetrack.
We'll take one more commercial break and then be back and stay with you unless there is a caution till the finish here. Live from Motegi, NASCAR Stock Car Racing. Buddy, eighth caution of the day, and it's a bad one. Brendan Gaughan's number 16 is gone, up in flames. And with it came the number 4. Totally destroyed is Bobby Hamilton's car. There you see it, lying toward the top of turn 4. Both drivers are out, though. Oh, look at how hard Hamilton hit. They are both out of their cars. That one is done forever. Gaughan had been running in 11th position earlier. And as you recall, he had a header dragging. They brought him in, came back out. He'd fallen off some positions. We'll try to get your replay here in a moment if we can. See what we have on that one a moment. They were running further back in the field. Bobby Hamilton had fallen. He was just outside the top 10 when this incident took place. Well, that's over and gone.
Something blew out there.
That was the left rear tire that exploded. You could see it when it melted outer tire and then air came out. It blew it across the racetrack there.
That's several moments after it happened. They were on the scene, but there's the result. 22 lead changes among 7 drivers, 8 cautions to date. And this is the most serious incident that we have had here at Motegi. Brendan Gaughan out of Las Vegas, Nevada.
There he is, walking
away. 2 top 5s in Winston-West this year. He was 24th in points. A big off-road racer, desert racer, and is running the Winston-West Series this year. In fact, his brother John just won the El Dorado 250 last week, a major race out there in the desert. So, here's the situation as we get down to the end of this one. The laps are running out. We're down toward the end of it. We've got a serious caution here. I think we'll get 2 or 3 laps in to decide it. But that's the end of the day for the number 4 car and the hopes of Bobby Hamilton and this crew that have been here, and they have given so much to this race over and over again. The Bobby Hamilton crew have been here and worked hard to make sure that folks in Japan saw the top cars. Larry McClure, his brother, were both here. It's a sad way to end it. And the Napa car, number 16, the Kodak car, you see the 16 on the hook coming in. And I think they're going to get a rollback out there on the number 4.
You know, the first thing that Brendan Gaughan did when he got stopped was run over and assist the workers to get Bobby Hamilton out of the car.
Yeah, he's only 23, but he's had a lot of experience in desert racing. His family came out of that sort of background. As we say, his brother John is still very much involved. His dad had 30 years in desert racing. He really wants to make a go of it, and he's one of those really determined kids that will speak well for Winston West in the future. There he is as he extricated himself, and it took him a little while to get out. That thing was burning for maybe 15, 20 seconds before he clambered out. We hadn't seen Bobby Hamilton move until right there as he came around.
You could see him take the window net down to make sure Bobby Hamilton was okay.
And on this caution, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has just pitted. He is pitting. Well, it's going to cost him some spots and not much time to make him back up again.
Let's check on our number of laps remaining to be run here to finish this one off. 311 is the total, and we're at 88. We're at 192. We are at 192. So Skinner, Burton, Gordon, Mayfield, Wallace round out the top five. Dale Earnhardt just outside of that, followed by Bill Elliott, Sterling Marlin, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. at 192 being shown in ninth. Now, he is pitted. I wonder if that's going to stay
up. Look in 10th place there. Lance Norrick is not a regular on this with the Winston Cup guys at all. Has battled his way all the way into the top 10. He's very good in the truck series, but he's doing a very nice job in the number 60 car today.
What a hard way to end the life of car number four. Well, we'll take a commercial break under caution and then be back with you again. Here's the Plaza at Motegi. 65 miles north and west of Tokyo. Four 311 laps complete. The Earnhardt story. Well, at the present time, Dale Earnhardt Sr. is sixth and Dale Earnhardt Jr. is eighth. The Gordon domination, the end of the season in question as he rides in third, behind Mike Skinner and Jeff Burton. Japanese racers, not a factor. Battling the track, that's the story. That's what's brought us to this point in the eighth caution of the day after a hard crash has eliminated Bobby Hamilton, who walked all the way back to the area where he was given. There you see him going back after a brutal hit, but he picks himself up. Saw him at breakfast at 6 this morning, ready to go.
Just amazing he walked away from that wreck. That car was bent all the way back to the seat. Working hard up there in that turn to try to get this thing back under green again.
The work is discontinued. They're ready to go again.
Some Earnhardt fans wanting to see this one go for the 3 or the 1 car before it's over. And Burns has Bobby Hamilton.
Steve? Yeah, Bobby Hamilton is here, Ken. Boy, Bobby, it looked like quite an accident.
It was. I'm surprised. I mean, it jarred me pretty good, but I'm surprised it didn't hurt worse than it did because it was a heck of a lick, but just got tied up with the lap car, I think. Larry said clear. He said once he cleared me, I drove in, said he just kept accelerating on in, but it's probably a payback for me accidentally hitting Darrell. He went in there and got a little loose, and I tagged him, and he lost his car and hit it. I hated that, but, you know, it's not a point event. We've been in one wreck this year. That was at Talladega. It's the only wreck we've been in all year, so we've had a good year for that, but, you know, we want to have a good run here for Kodak because it's a big deal for them, but at least we'll put a show on.
Yeah, Darrell said it was going to be a long flight back. He was on your plane.
Yeah, I know it. He'll scold me. I said, I'm probably the only fella in the world that wrecked his hero. Oh, well. I'm sorry, Darrell.
All right, glad you're okay.
All right, thank you.
He had only one DNF all year long until this, and that was that Talladega crash.
Take a look at the top 10 here. Skinner first, Burton second, and Burton was closing on Skinner. Now 311 makes the distance, and already those safety crews are moving back. They've done a little dusting up there, and I can see a couple of vehicles that are going to turn and make a pass through the fire chemical that was laid down for Brendan Gaughan's number 16 Napa car that got tangled. It was a lap car with a Kodak number 4.
Upstairs is not going to be a good place to go in that third and fourth turn, but downstairs is still nice and clean. Tires are cooled off. What's going to happen now when they drop the green flag?
Hard tires, cold day. Bad formula. Frankie Stoddard, crew chief on number 99, standing by with Alan Vesper.
Well, Frank was over here lobbying the NASCAR officials maybe to get a red flag while this cleanup was going on. You got enough to get around Skinner?
Well, I think the driver does. I don't know if the car's good enough. We worked hard on it all week, and I think it is. You know, he was tracking him down, and we were trying to save a little bit of fuel because we were maybe going to be two laps short. So, it's great to come over here and run in front of all these Japanese fans and Bruce Lee on the car and stuff. And we'd like to finish this thing off, right? We worked hard in practice on just race setups and gave up qualifying because we figured we could qualify in the top 25 here. You know, maybe back in the States we'd have been in trouble, but we ended up sixth, and Jeff's done a great job all weekend. He's got about six or seven more laps here to see who's the best.
And a restart coming up in one more lap. That's Frank Stoddard, Jeff Burton's crew chief.
Boy, oh boy, I tell you what, the dress rehearsal's over. This is going to be a tug of war right here. Those first five cars right there are major league bad, and just behind them are some good, good race cars also.
Jeff Burton's had a darn good year. Here's the story on it. Let's review Jeff Burton's two wins this season. Victory one took place at Loudoun, New Hampshire. Win two became a battle of the two Jeffs at Richmond, Virginia. It was Jeff Gordon to the inside, Jeff Burton on the high side, down to the checkers. In the closest finish of the season, Jeff Burton the winner. Will it be win number three on a major super speedway? This one in Motegi, Japan, where TBS is with you live on a Saturday night, Sunday morning in the old US of A. Getting along toward 3:30 in the afternoon. Very chilly here in Motegi. Hard tires. Not a good formula.
Earnhardt Jr., four fresh tires. Made a pit stop. Will he have enough?
Down to it.
A green flag. All clear, all clear. Two car lengths back.
11 kilometers.
Tear this thing up clear.
Here they go. This is it.
Jeff Gordon looking all over the back of Burton as he head down into turn three.
Gordon's there. Skinner sprints away. In first place. Here comes Gordon after it. And here comes Jeremy Mayfield down for third.
Clear all around, buddy. Just now watch up ahead of you. You go get him.
Look at these guys. They're all over the racetrack.
Look at Earnhardt Jr. He's cleared Bill Elliott. That's Dale Sr. there on the outside trying to get by Bill Elliott. They fight their way down towards the back straightaway.
Yeah, what a start. He's come from eighth up to sixth. Earnhardt Jr. got his dad behind him and also put Elliott away. And fresh tires on that car.
Jeff Gordon looking to the inside of Mike Skinner as they head down towards the front straightaway. Looked like Jeff Gordon right at the moment has turned it up another notch.
Skinner in first trying to repulse Jeff Gordon in that second spot with three to go.
Well, I tell you, Mike Skinner is flying up out of the corner. He put three car lengths on Jeff Gordon as they come off turn two over there.
Battle raging here in Japan as Gordon closes down on Skinner again.
Jeff Burton has to feel like he's been beat up because once they started back, it takes his car about 10 laps to get up to speed.
Two to go.
Right now he's dropped several positions.
Skinner stays in first. Here comes Gordon after him. Into turn one. Jeff Gordon with 13 wins this year. Mike Skinner, who won in Japan last year, his only major win at Suzuka on the road course.
Boy,
now trying to be that first winner on a super speedway in Japan.
These two Chevrolets are so equally matched right there. Gordon's a little better in the center part of the corner. Mike Skinner a little better as they exit the corner.
One to go here. Be smooth. Hit your mark down here. Keep it on the bottom of three and four.
Taking the white flag. Taking that mark into turn.
this turn two on the second lap of practice and slapped the wall.
All right, he pulled it about two car lengths. Be smooth down here. Keep it on the bottom.
Skinner protecting that bottom. Final moments. Turn three. Gordon turns it up. Here he comes, cranking it up on the bottom.
Inside
moving
corner,
closer.
Corner.
Inching it up. Here
clear.
They come for the finish.
Atta
Skinner
boy.
Stays in front.
Yeah, goddamn it. We beat that whole time.
All right. Get it.
Attaboy, good job, guys. This son of a bitch pushed like a plow, Larry.
Oh,
I know you hate to hear it, but she pushed mad. Good. I
very enthusiastic about this victory down there, aren't they?
These people, a Polish victory lap. Every driver I win my first race with, I want a Polish victory lap. Show them what one's about.
You got her, bud. Anything you say, Larry. We said we'd win a race before the year was over, and we did it. We the T-Time champ. Now, God almighty, this is bad to the bone, boys.
Mike Skinner is dad to the bone indeed. What a run. And Larry McReynolds putting on those sequins.
But it was going to be
yeah. Oh, what a finish that was. Jeff Gordon came right down to the inside and turned four, buddy, tried to make the move, and Skinner wasn't going to give it up.
Well, he did everything he could do. Mike Skinner just had a real strong car up out of the corner. That was the difference.
Here we go. Thank you, Michael Skinner. Don't see that. Where'd the car go? I wonder what McReynolds is thinking right now. Let's go down trackside.
Laughing right now is what he's doing, Ken. Larry, congratulations. We saw you on the airplane over here pouring over the notes. Your weekend started off rough with a crash early in practice, and yet you ended up in victory lane.
Well, you know, I can't say enough for this Lowe's team. You know, when we did crash practice on Friday, everybody just jumped in. Nobody panicked, and three car pitched in. All them guys, I want to say a tribute to them. They jumped in there. That's what teamwork's about. Engine was awesome. We turned that thing 9,200. Spinny, I'm telling you, 9,200 all weekend. And just an awesome deal, you know. I just want to win a points event. We didn't get that done. So this will be a good start maybe to 1999.
A good weekend for you. Congratulations.
I appreciate it. Linda, Brooke, Brandon, Kendall, be home sometime whenever they let me out of this place. So looking forward to getting home.
All right, Larry McReynolds, the winning crew chief. He's headed for victory lane to join the celebration.
Here he is. Mike Skinner's done it. Larry McReynolds for Plastico, the crew chief that pulled it off in the winning car today. Plastico, the official spray paint of NASCAR, proud to sponsor that winning fish award. Keep it up. Michael Burnham right to the ground. This year is finished with an exclamation mark for Mike Skinner. Congratulations from Plastico to Larry McReynolds. Job he did today in putting Mike Skinner right back at the top of the heap.
All right, you won.
Join Mike Skinner in victory lane.
And Ken, Mike Skinner climbs out of the car. It's 2 years in a row. Mike Skinner wins in Japan. Mike. Gonna congratulate him by the team. He's gonna dive. That was big. Trying to get on through here. Grabs Larry McReynolds. All right, good stuff. Well, Mike, tell us, that's two times in Japan. Congratulations.
I'll tell you, this race team been coming. A lot of drivers said they're gonna win the race before the end of the year was out. And doggone, we didn't do it, but we keep winning these non-points races. But Jeff Gordon, I knew was going to be tough. It looked like Jeff Burton had the best car at the end of the race. The caution came out. We needed the caution. Our car was pushing really, really bad. And I was trying so hard not to overdrive it. Tim Overby, Richard, Larry, everybody's going, just stay, keep that thing on the bottom. I was cussing. I said, it won't stay on the bottom. We'll stay nowhere. But Lowe's. Thank you very much. Cobalt, this is a good way to start a new relationship with Cobalt Tools. And Chevrolet wins another one. Awesome. Goodyear had a great tire today. I want to thank my car owner, Judy. She didn't come, but she sent Richard to stand in for her. And we beat him again, Judy.
Now, Mike, this wasn't a points race, as you said, but you guys have built so much momentum the last half of the season. You guys were a factor just about every single week down the stretch.
Well, you know, after a while, it starts looking impossible to beat the 24. I mean, everybody's going to just, what can you do to beat him? And everybody's going, hey, we're doing everything we can, you know. I don't know what would have happened if there had been another lap to go. Jeff was a little better down here. We were a little better over there. Might have been a heck of a wreck. I don't know. I wouldn't have wrecked him to win the race, but doggone, we finally, somebody beat the 24. It was pretty awesome. I want to thanks Jeff for Gordon. He could have turned me around down there, and he didn't do it. I really appreciate that. Congratulations to them and all the other drivers that came over to this big pond, over the big pond to race over here. And I tell you, there's some people I really want to thank, and all the people back in Susanville, California that helped me and get started in racing. And we used to race on a half-mile dirt track there, and it was kind of a dream back then, and stuff, days like today make those dreams come true. And Larry McReynolds, man, he's been awesome. Kevin Hamlin, he's been a lot of help and support to me. Kevin and I are great friends. We swapped crew chiefs. We won with Kevin, now we won with Larry. Larry finally got a Polish victory lap. It's a pretty awesome day for Lowe's and all his team. And these guys got us out, the pit crew, world champion pit crew. I'll tell you what, I was ashamed so many times because they had a good enough pit stop to win the race and their driver let them down or the car wasn't good enough. Got you one today, boys.
All right, congratulations. Let's go to Alan Bestwick.
All right, well, Jeff Gordon gave Mike Skinner a run off that last corner. Tell me about those last few laps.
That was my Japanese version of a bonsai. I didn't really have a prayer to get him, but, you know, we had a great car. We had a lot of fun out there. I can tell you that. There's a lot of swapping positions. It was hard to stay in the front, and Mike did it best at the end and won the race. And, you know, you got to take your hat off to him. They did a great job, but... that last pit stop hurt us. My car just picked up a little bit of a push. Plus, we got behind. You know, when we could get out front and get away, the car was perfect. But every time I'd get up close to him, I'd get real tight. And there at the end, I got a run on him going into three, and I just tried to make it happen. Maybe if I could only get my nose underneath him. I got it underneath him, and he did what he needed to do, and I just slid back up in the groove and followed him to the checker.
Well, for a car that got wrinkled up in the early laps, it wasn't bad, and as has been his trademark, the last laps are always exciting when Jeff Gordon's around. Ken?
Sure was exciting, but the tables were turned today. Look at the signature here in the main straightaway. That's the writing of a fellow named Skinner from Susanville, California, about to take a lap of honor around this mile-and-a-half, $400 million facility. Go to it, Mike Skinner. You deserve it. This is your day in Japan. Second year he's done it, once on a road course, and now here is going to be a big favorite in Japan. They've got to bring him back. Oh, my heart. Imagine, on a road course, buddy, and then he does it again today on the oval.
Great, great, great job by the Larry McReynolds. Also, Mike Skinner, he has a lot of talent, and as I said in the middle part of the race, you're going to hear a lot about him in years to come.
Mike Skinner, the winner today at Motegi. What a story this has been. Finishing second, Jeff Gordon. Jeremy Mayfield third. And going in fourth was number 99 at the finish, Jeff Burton. All of them play to that lead one time or another in 311 miles. Wrap up in a moment. Five at Motegi. There's the top 10 as they came across. As you know, we did this without scoring any of the usual scoring. So I can tell you that Scott Gaylord got 11, and Anaheim kills California's Jeff Davis, the sports car champion. He got himself 12th today. But Skinner's the man. Gordon's in second. Hey, Baker, remember Harry High, that wonderful, salty old crew chief? I think we ought to have a new award and have the Harry High Crew Chief Award to the crew chief who verbalizes things the best, and give it today for sure to Larry McReynolds.
Absolutely.
Right in the Harry High tradition.
You have to believe that. Everybody said, I bet Mike Skinner's cold out there riding on top of that convertible. Believe you me, he's feeling great right now. There is no such thing as cold.
Hey, what about Dale Earnhardt Jr., Alan Bestwick?
Well, he's just etched outside here. All right, sixth place, your first go in a Winston Cup race. How do you feel?
Pretty happy. I hope Tony Urie and everybody back home's happy with the job we did. We kind of represent DEI, and I hope everybody enjoyed the race. It's a good car. We struggled with it a little bit. We were kind of slim on practice time, so we really didn't get to work with the car a whole lot. So we kind of had to shoot in the dark this morning. But we're pretty happy with our results, and I'm ready to get home, build some cars of our own, because I believe we got something.
All right, now tell me the truth. Was it in your goal anywhere this weekend to make sure you beat Dad? I mean, you did.
Well, that was kind of important. I don't think he was too happy about it, but I'll be all right. I think when we get home, Tony Urie had my back. He kind of understands how it is.
There you go. Nice job today. Dale Earnhardt Jr. finishing sixth. Ken?
Now, here's the real story. He almost wasn't here. You know why, Baker?
No.
His father forgot him. He got almost to the airport, and Teresa said, weren't you supposed to get Dale Jr.? He said, oh, my heart. Turned around, had to go back and get him. That's how close it was that you didn't have the sixth-place finisher who beat the man who almost forgot him, Earnhardt Sr. Great family, great story, tremendous story for motorsports, the Earnhardts for sure. And Mike Skinner has certainly contributed here. The first true export of real American stock car racing. Here on this mile and a half at Motegi, Mike Skinner has won it and signed his name all down the main straightaway as he slid those good years around. Pretty nice day, buddy.
Absolutely, and this racetrack was fabulous. I thought we had good lead changes, 22 to be exact, so that's good racing. I enjoyed the whole day.
Oh, it was wonderful. On Sunday, December 13th at 9, it's the Discover Stars on Ice that features Tara Lipinski and other top skaters. Catch all the action only on the TBS Superstation. After this race, Emilio Estevez and Sutherland and Christian Slater are on the run from the law. Young Guns 2, that's coming up next on the Superstation. So for Alan Bestwick, Steve Burns, Dick Berggren, and Buddy Baker, I'm Ken Squire saying so long from Motegi in Japan. Sunday, December 19th, Tara Lipinski stars in Discover Stars on Ice. And coming up next, Young Guns 2.